nerderotic.com.
Damn, Gary, some serious gourmet shit. What flavor is this?
That's right, it's the All Hell Medium Roast Private Blend. Check out the Geek Grind Coffee Nerdrotic page for our other options like the Decadent Feathers of Liberty vanilla-infused flavored coffee. Or if you're looking for something darker, try the Dark Roast F&T Blend of the Fellowship. You know what? Just buy all three. GeekGrindCoffee.com. Use discount code Nerdrotic. Huzzah!
Look, this is crazy. Man, don't y'all smoke that shit. Easy to ride. Look. Man, this is crazy, man. I'm telling you. This is fighting in traffic, bruh. Look. He needs somebody to spot with. I shit, I go spot with this. Look. This is crazy. He tied now.
Looking for somebody to spar with. Hi, everybody.
I'm going to come.
Yeah.
Oh,
indeed.
Oh. Hi. We're waiting on Chris. He's probably asleep. You know how those West Coast California guys are.
Yeah. Always late to things.
California guys. Shit. Thank God we're Texans.
Yep.
That's right.
Live in the great country of Texas.
Texas. The free Republic of Texas. You don't want to come here. Well, we put all our women in handmaidens.
Yep.
Costumes.
Mandatory uniform.
Our guns have more rights than them, for sure. Definitely for sure. So you don't want to come here. Pot's illegal. You
just yeah, want. Yeah.
It's a terrible place to come.
Terrible place to be.
Yeah, don't be here.
It's horrible.
Fucking Republicans. You might run into Alex Jones. He just runs around free, and you might run into him. That'd be very.
Yeah, cool. He could chase you around.
Chase you around.
Yeah. Call you garbage. I saw it firsthand, man.
Oh,
terrifying.
We have so much to talk about today. Hello, chat. You beautiful chat. How's it going? I'm getting caffeinated as we speak. I was up a little late last night watching Dankula's Mad Lads on Heaven's Gate.
I gotta watch that.
It's a good one. Because that one, what did I watch before that? The Gary, the guy who shot and killed the
Yes. What is his last name? I forgot what his name. Yeah.
Gary Pouch, something I can't remember now. That was a Pouchet? Good one. Pouchet. Yeah. Yeah. Legend.
Father of the year. Father of the decade. Of the
century.
Father of the century.
So I remember Heaven's Gate because on a fateful day in March of 1997, I was delivering auto parts for Worldpac. And I'm like, I'm going to cut through Rancho San. I lived in San Diego, North County. So, you know, a couple of times, not all the time, I'd cut through Rancho Santa Fe to avoid the traffic on Interstate 15. So this day I'm like, I'm going to cut through Rancho Santa Fe, hit the Del Dios Highway. You know, nobody knows what I'm talking about unless you live in San Diego. Well, on that day, Heaven's Gate decided to all kill themselves. So I got stuck in the company truck for 6 hours. They thought stole it. Okay. They thought I stole the fucking truck. So they called the police on me.
What the hell?
Yeah. Because I didn't have a cell phone. It was 1997. We had fucking pagers. So, like, they're trying to
pay. They thought you just took off. You're like, no, man. A cult killed themselves.
Yeah. A cult killed themselves. I'm stuck on this country road that's shut down. There's no payphones. I'm trying to flag down a cop so I can like, hey, but I'm like, oh God, they might just arrest me. So I'm like, that's probably not a good idea. So I just wait till the traffic starts. And, you know, then I get home and I call my boss. I'm like, dude, I got caught, you know, in the traffic and everything was fine. Everything's fine after that. But
I thought you were going to tell me a story like the 9/11 stories where they're like, I was about to get on a plane, man. But you're going to be like, I was about to, you know, go to another planet. I was hanging out with these people. They were really nice. They gave me some Nikes. And then I just wasn't able to make it to the party. I
wasn't able to. No, it wasn't like that. No. The website's still up.
It's still up. They still keep
it. They left two people behind to do the website, and they're still doing it. So
it's dedication.
Pretty crazy. What's up, Chris? How's it going?
How's it going, man?
Senator Gore. So
woke up this morning, and that link to the event like got out on the SDCC unofficial blog, and tickets like sold out like immediately. They're just gone.
Dude, yeah. It's awesome.
That's crazy. It's crazy.
It got out on their blog.
On their blog, they wrote about it. And like, I know those guys, they're cool. It's just, they write about stuff happening at San Diego Comic-Con that's sometimes related to the con officially and unofficial events surrounding. And I mean, I don't know. Is that a bad thing? I don't know.
Probably. Because our people didn't get a chance to get in there, but we'll see. Hopefully they figured it out.
Yeah, I know. So, I was just like, well, I'm going to start.
Didn't think that was going to happen.
Yeah, I didn't know either. I was just like, wait, what? So, and thank you, Garrett, for all the work on that. I do appreciate it. Yeah,
no problem.
So I don't know, like, because we were going to announce it like here, but it apparently got out and it sold out. So shit. Yeah,
sorry.
That sucks. But we have our event, right? Both events ended up on there.
Well,
that's not good.
Let's see. The meetup still has a few tickets left.
Yeah,
there's still a couple.
But yeah, if you want to find it, then you know we'll do just show up. We'll figure out a way. We will fucking figure out a way. So show up. Okay. We'll work it out. If I have to fucking just hang out with you guys outside the theater, that's what I'll do. I don't care.
Same here.
We'll get it figured out, but those links will probably be in the description now, right? And then I'll throw it up on Twitter. So what's the name of the theater? I don't even know that, like, the name
Landmark Cinema.
Hillcrest Landmark Cinemas.
Oh, I know where that is. I saw Pulp Fiction there. Okay, good place. Yes.
Yeah. So that's the theater, but there's like 220 seats in the theater. So, you know,
you gotta get there early if you wanna.
Yeah.
Yeah. So what happens is we RSVP, we book, people don't show up. That's generally what happens, right?
Yeah. With San Diego Comic-Con, I'm going to admit I'm totally guilty of, I RSVP for everything. Then I kind of look at what's happening and go, oh, I want to do this, this, and this. I already know I'm on the list. So that has been my strategy in the past. So I think you can you could have twice as many people saying they're coming, but half the people are just going to bail because they're doing something else or couldn't make it or whatever. So I think we're fine, actually.
We're good. But we're good. Like I said, show up.
What a weird morning, Gary. Just two things. I don't know if you keep up with this stuff or this affects you. Two quick things. Alex Berenson is back on Twitter because he won his lawsuit against Twitter. I don't know if you know who Alex Berenson is.
No.
He was banned from Twitter a year ago for saying the COOF jab is a therapeutic and not a vax.
It's not. That's a fact. So he got banned for that.
He got banned for that. It was a famous ban. Alex Berenson, he's been on Joe Rogan. He's, you know, very outspoken, and he's a former New York Times journalist, but he's like an old school journalist. Like, he likes to, you know, confirm things with two facts. He tries to not put in any sort of agenda or message. It's just, he's a report the facts kind of guy, right? Mm-hmm. And he's been on Rogan and a lot of other podcasts and whatnot. So yeah, he was famously banned about a year ago. Filed a lawsuit against Twitter saying what I said was true, and then they finally confirmed what he said is true. He's back on Twitter. It's kind of a big deal, and it'll hit the news. The other thing is, someone bombed the Georgia Guidestones. I just heard.
Why?
What?
Someone exploded, and yeah, like you can look up, you can look it up right now. But yeah, they bombed it. Like, and so first destroyed? Of all, you probably need to, it's not totally destroyed, but a bunch of it is just like, yeah, it's because it's a bunch of these stone tablets with these. Anyone who doesn't know what the Georgia Guidestones are, there's like these weird. It was like 1980 or something. They appeared in some national forest. Like, no one knows who put them up. And they just appeared, and it's all these sort of rules for how Earth will, you know, yeah. Is that the picture of the blown up? Yeah, pretty bizarre, right? So this happened.
So it's like a monument out there that somebody just blew up.
It's a monument, but it's weird because it says stuff like
it's like about like how,
yeah, like there should only be five, like keep the population to 500 million. Like this weird sort of elite, like, look, I'm surprised there hasn't been like, and maybe there has been like some sort of weird movie about it. Wait, go back to the dog. I'm kidding. That was a very
look at it.
I'm not.
Wow.
Yeah.
Yeah.
I mean, yeah. I'm not upset. I give a shit. Anything that says keep the population under 500.
I wonder who did it though.
Stonehenge, I'd be upset. I'd be really pissed. I'd be ready to go to war for that shit, but these things.
Yeah, Georgia Guidestone's weird. Anyways, that's just weird. That's my morning. Apologies for being late.
That's all right. Weird. Now mine weird. was getting pings at 3 a.m. because of a Amazon Prime trailer. So I just threw my phone across the room. I just let
What? Now. Is there a new trailer?
Yeah, there is. But they did not put it on YouTube. They did not put it on YouTube because they fear the ratio. But we'll watch it. We're going to watch it anyway. Fair use. I'm a Prime member. And for people go, it's trying to steer people to Prime. Please. Prime has how many? Okay, we're talking about the video service. Well, I'll be generous. 200 million subscribers. There's about that many people currently using YouTube right now. Not just a subscriber, using it. Active user on the platform. Doing their shit. Watching it. That never happens for Amazon Prime. Okay? Yeah. That just never happens. So why? And plus, you put your trailer over here. It gets replicated. You get free advertising. Plus, they earn income on the 30 million views they'll get. Mm-hmm. You know? I mean, it's pennies to a $1 trillion corporation, but I mean, we're in an age where your ad can earn money. So why not put it on YouTube? Because you're scared of the ratio, but they got rid of the dislike button to protect the small creators.
It's our mental health.
Think of the small creators. Who can still see all their dislikes, by the way.
Yeah.
And can discourage them anyway. So. It's we're gonna go over that. We're definitely that was my morning.
Gary, another trailer dropped. I don't know how important this is to you. The trailer for Clerks 3 dropped. Clerks? I mean, literally like 30 minutes ago.
Yeah. Yeah.
I don't know if you care. It's I watched it. It's kind of weird. It's like this meta thing where Randall, like he has some traumatic health event and realizes he wants to make the movie, and the movie he's making is Clerks. It's all in jokes about the Clerks movie. So you kind of really need to be
like, what was great about the first Clerks is that it was just a real, you know, albeit like kind of a heightened version of what it's like to work at a retail place with nobody around. Yes. And it's, you know, kind of silly situations, but it feels real. And this, the kind of like in joke stuff is just so bad to me. Like, that is not what the original was. Well, and even the second one was that way.
A lot of in jokes, like a lot. So I don't know. I think Rings is going to be more interesting, Gary.
Yeah. I mean, we'll watch it. I mean, Kevin Smith, I mean, if he made a movie about a celebrity who's, his fame has outlived his talent for some reason and then betrayed everything he was about
Super meta, man.
Becoming a massive sellout in Hollywood. Then I'd watch it, sure. Maybe he'll cry to his own trailer. Do you think he'll do that, Chris? Do you think he'll do a reaction to his own trailer and cry?
He should do a reaction. It's a weird thing. Well, first of all, it's a weird thing that he's crying so much, right? Like he said, so much success in his career. But the constant posting on social media of, you know, breaking down is just like, why are you doing that? I always question, did you see the nurse that went viral where she just lost a patient but had sort of time to set up and do a TikTok video of herself at the moment she lost the patient? It was just, I don't know. I think social media just exacerbates any sort of potential. Yeah, mental
it does.
Illness.
It does. My wife schooled me on that one. It's called Everything is Content. Apparently it's a TikTok thing. It's like going and taking a shit is content. Cooking your meal is content. Your day at work at LinkedIn. Did you see It's a Gundam's last video?
No.
Dude, oh, yeah. He's great.
So good at what he does. Yes.
Yeah, he's great.
I love Gundam. He was supposed to be, I guess, do four, and he couldn't get through one. And it's some vapid chick who supposedly works at LinkedIn. And it was just her taking breaks for lunch and having a conference where they sang Mamma Mia. And then she took a break for later lunch or whatever. Then she went to a party and then a party after the party. And then she realized she still had her work laptop with her and she was going to go to bed after that hard day's work.
Jesus.
You know what? I know why people hate us. I do. I mean, I completely understand us Americans. Like, I get it. If that's all you see in the world, I don't blame you. But we're not all like that. But it was bad.
These generations, man.
I know. I've worked at a kind of a tech company. They didn't give us lunch. We had to pay for lunch. but it was Technicolor. So they're French. They were French at the time, owned by some Frenchies. So, of course, they were going to make us pay. Chris.
Yes.
How you feeling about your doc? How are you feeling about your doc, dude?
I'm nervous about it. I mean, I'm just, first of all, it's not going to look great because it's the rough cut, but this is the purpose of doing this. But we've sort of, you know, I don't want to get into boring technical stuff like sound mix and color correction, but it's not any of those things. So it is a cut of the doc. And I think there's some, I want to see if certain jokes land or certain subtle things people pick up. And there's a lot of things you'll see in this movie about Attack of the Show that, like, I mean, I didn't know when I started making it, like, you know, I was there and I'm interviewing people who were like the two directors of the show, the executive producer, you know, who also like helped create the Stern Show at E. This guy, John Reiber. Yeah, he was very instrumental in creating the E Howard Stern Show. And I interviewed him for the doc, among other people. So there's people who've never really talked about this. And then a lot of inside info were like, oh, that's surprising. Like, you know, who, you know, before Olivia was cast, there were other people that were considered. I just learning that stuff is real interesting. So, and there's a lot of fun stuff in there too. I don't want to spoil anything, but it'll be fun. It'll be fun to see it with an audience, and it's a rough cut that'll help us go, okay, we need to cut another 5 minutes, or we need to tighten this or that. So we're at the end of the process, and it's
nice.
It's weird. We should have a conversation about making docs. But I feel like every time I see It's a Gundam thing, it's like a mini doc from a comedian, you know?
Yeah,
like,
that's why it's so great.
Approaches it is like he goes into such detail, then he'll go off on tangents and then get right back to the main topic. And It's a Gundam is just, yeah, I love his stuff. So bringing up that doc was great, or the latest video of his.
And I can't wait to see his next one because I think it's about Kenobi, but I'm not supposed to say that.
Is it? Oh God, that's great.
If it comes out, like I start so many videos now. I end up not throwing them away. I'll start them and I'll file them away.
Yeah, put them on the shelf for
later.
Put them
on the shelf. Something else comes up, I just break out the shirt I was wearing before and finish it. You know. Yeah, CERN was activated yesterday. That would explain a lot, actually. And now the EU goes nuke and gas in green. And now that stone, what a time to live in. Yeah. It's weird.
It is weird. Are we going to jump back to the other universe where everything wasn't fucked up? I hope so. I hope so.
Yeah.
Because they turned it back on. So
maybe Sean Connery's still alive. And, like, you know, that's what I was talking about.
That would be great.
Maybe there's a Mandela effect, you know?
Maybe he just shows back up.
There's a good Star Wars out there. No, let's not get crazy. Let's not get crazy. The two towers are still standing, you know?
Yeah.
Building 7 is still standing.
The federal government. What?
The Federal Reserve was audited.
Somebody looked at it.
Dispersed. And then, then the FBI was dispersed. Never mind. Thank you. Again, that was Svinsted for 50 Danish krona. Says CERN was activated yesterday. Now that you go nuke and gas nuke and grass is green. And now that stone, what a time to live in. Indeed. I think we should greet everybody and then just get right into that fucking trailer.
I think
we should do it. But first, let's see who's here. We got Kuso Cat. How's it going? Eric K and his wrench, just another red shirt. Savage Talk, welcome. Flag Ninja, Bastard, all members, by the way. Another Gen 42. Hey, what's up? How's it going? Kavinsky Smith, Preserving Light, Van Vital, J Wan, and a nobody at all. A nobody at all. I get it. I get what you're trying to say.
No.
Justin Brown, Fletcher Williams. Kenny Cross, Johnny Brown. Is there any? No, that's Justin Brown. Sorry, did I say Fletcher? I must have. Fletcher Williams, Justin Brown, and Johnny Brown. Are you guys related?
The whole Brown family.
It's like the whole Brown family is here. We got this. Said Aid Robertson for $17.99. That's British money. That's proper. Hail Chris Garrett. And Gary, take my money. Thank you.
Hail.
Put it to horrible use. Horrible, horrible use. And Ahura Mazda, Painted Blue, Monopoly. I get what you're doing there. And Leslie Bedingfield, how are you? Welcome to the Nerdrotic Nooner. I guess because we missed it before. Hang on. Right, but it's the applause. We're all here. I'm pretty caffeinated now.
Oh,
I'm going to come. So you got that trailer?
I got it.
Let's
subject ourselves to this trailer.
Let's see it. You ready, Chris?
Let's do it.
He sounds so excited. Doesn't
yeah,
I can feel Chris
I'm
is
not,
excited.
I'm not excited. I'm not excited, to be honest.
I know. You don't even care.
I don't really care.
Okay, I just wanted to tell you that this is a teaser. So we've seen two teasers. We've seen a making the sign, mm-hmm. and then we saw the infamous teaser where we saw our girl warrior Galadriel climbing a mountain with a knife.
Don't you ever wonder what else is out there?
I can feel it.
I can feel it.
Yeah. And then, we got nothing. We got the super fan reaction to the trailer. Then we got a couple of commercials, very diverse commercials. Everything has been ratioed to hell. And I mean, not just slightly ratioed or a little bit of ratioed, like uber ratioed,
including this re-upload. Somebody found the trailer, re-uploaded it. And it's
somebody was going to do
also. Also ratio. So
Amazon, in their infinite wisdom, decided to tease a trailer because we're teasing trailers now, and it's not just Amazon. I fucking hate this, by the way, Chris. Tell your people in Hollywood to stop it.
Stop it.
It's a teaser for a teaser for a trailer. It's a commercial.
I hate that the dumb thing they put in the first 5 seconds of a trailer where they basically, it's a trailer for
ruin
the trailer.
It.
But this teaser is only 55 seconds. We still don't. 55 seconds.
We don't have a full trailer for Amazon's The Rings of Power, their tentpole, the most expensive show ever fucking made, does not have a trailer, and it comes out in less than 2 months.
Yep.
Eternals. the Eternals. It's the same shit. They know they have a giant piece of shit. And listen, I know the plot for episodes 1 through 7. I know what happens, and it's not a lot. It's not a lot. They're building up these characters, right? And they're supposed to be super interesting, and they're just not. Apparently, the acting is pretty wooden. The dialogue is pretty cringe. And Galadriel is, I know this is going to surprise you, an insufferable bitch that nobody will like. So, and this comes, someday I'll be able to tell you. Someday, maybe, I'll be able to tell
well,
you.
Well, hey, the directors themselves said she's full of piss and vinegar.
Piss and vinegar.
Our Galadriel.
Yeah, our girl Galadriel.
Our girl Galadriel.
I showed a picture of still from this, and the first thing Lady Gravemaster said is, what the fuck's wrong with her teeth? So we'll see. I don't know. That's the first thing I saw too. But let's get into this, and then I'll give you more context of like what, who is what they're looking at, and why this show probably, I mean, out of anything else, will probably bore the shit out of you. So let's do this. I can't hear it.
Is it not loud enough?
No, that's better. It's pretty low. Start over.
I wonder if it's the re-upload where they may have dropped it.
The skies are strange.
Yeah, it's like it's playing through here. Let me try it.
It's really low on my end too, and it's like all the way up.
Yeah. Maybe I should just play the fucking Amazon version.
Just from Amazon?
From Amazon. Do you think I should? Chat, what do you think? Are you good with this, or do you want the...
Just roll with it.
It's got Turkish subtitles. Are they? Let's just roll with it. Fuck it. Well, we have to stop anyway. So, what you've seen so far is Lenny Henry's Harfoot, because we cannot call them hobbits. Notice that? They started calling them hobbits, but then later on, they're like, no. They're predecessors of hobbits. No, they're not. They're fucking hobbits. They're a species of hobbit. The overall species is hobbit. And then they have they have the Harfoots, Sores, and the Fallowhides. So, yeah. And what else we've seen? We saw Gil-galad. Now, I haven't got confirmation how much he's in the show. I think that's one of the questions I'll have for the entities that I may or may not be speaking with, is like, how much is Gil-galad, the High King, in the show? Because he's the one guy that looks like an elf. Looks like an elf.
He's the only one.
All the fucking elves should look like is Gil-galad. Now, why is he the only one who looks like that? Why are he and Galadriel the only ones with long hair? There is some speculation that it might be status. I think they're right, but maybe not within the show, within the message. Because I absolutely agree with the assessment from yesterday that we talked about on the Real BBC, that Elrond and Celebrimbor having short hair is a way to kind of snip their balls to make them look less than, which they're not. So this is there's definitely like Gil-galad's the king, but why would you do that? Why would you aesthetically make them? And we can sit there and argue with the fucking experts all day long on did elves have long hair or not. It doesn't matter. It looks better. That looks better. Aesthetically, yeah. It looks better. They look like shit.
I was watching a whole Weta documentary about how they did the costuming. I watched it yesterday. And she was talking about how they were making all the costuming and the hair and everything very long and flowy because they wanted the elves to look tall. And like it was an aesthetic thing. And whenever you cut their hair short like that, they look like weird soccer moms that would post stuff on Facebook about not having their coffee yet. It just looks strange.
For one, Galadriel is fucking tall, by the way. She's supposed to be really tall, yeah. Like over 6 feet. She's as tall as Celeborn, who's like 6'4", 6'5". So all elves are supposed to be tall, very tall. And little Elrond looks like a little Elrond.
Little Elrond.
Burn in hell, Amazon. Yeah, the chat's not liking it.
No, not a fan. Let's keep going.
Yeah. That's the scene where Lady Grandmaster,
with their teeth?
Yeah, when Lady Grandmaster saw that still, and she's like, what the fuck's wrong with their teeth?
It's like one like, way higher than the other one.
You know, European.
It's British.
See, that looks fine. That looks fine. That doesn't look fine. No. That looks stupid. Okay, well, go back. Go back. Go back, because Lady Grandmaster caught this. Look at their fucking helmets. That looks like it was 3D printed, dude.
It does.
It's a billion-dollar TV show, and it looks like they're standing in front of a green screen.
100% on a green screen here.
And it's look at all the diverse people. Look at the fiery rock fly by. That's all this is. Oh, no. Okay, so we're going to, like, I want you to take it to the front again. We're going to go back into the left here a little bit, folks.
Back into the
little JFK on this one. Sorry, Chris Gore. So let it run.
I love it.
Let it run. Okay. There we go. We're going to start out with an original character. Stop right there. That is not a character from anywhere in Tolkien's Legendarium. And this is what, again, we open up our trailer with.
Again.
Because we need to show diversity with the hobbits because it's a giant global disaster. No, I mean, I'm supposed to appeal to a giant global audience, which it already did, by the way, except in China, of course. So continue.
Are strange.
Okay. So we got Gil-galad again, recycled scene of Gil-galad. It's just extended a little bit, which makes me think, for one,
it's all they got.
A show called The Rings of Power, my Tolkien brothers and sisters will understand this, absolutely should star Galadriel. Absolutely. Yeah. Our Galadriel. Tolkien's Galadriel. The other two characters, it should star. I mean, it's arguable, but we're talking about The Rings of Power. So we're talking about the forging of the rings. So absolutely, Gil-galad. And then you can argue the other star should be Cured in the Shipwright or Celebrimbor.
Celebrimbor, yeah.
Probably Celebrimbor, okay? But the other one ends up being a ring bearer later. Then you have Celeborn, then you have Elrond, and, you know, you go on from there. So he'll be like a sub-character. Like, he'll probably be, you know, I would say a B-lister in the show. Be in the show a little bit, but not as much as he should be.
He's a male leader. They can't possibly have him in the center of the story.
Possibly have him in there. Let's just call it for what it is. Continue. That looks stupid.
So there's some elves in the background that also have short hair.
Go back.
Short hair here.
All the fucking elves have short hair.
Like, this is like a bald person back here almost.
And they're supposed to be, I don't know if they're supposed to be going to, okay, the way it was described to me was different, because this shouldn't happen in the Second Age, right? So they're supposed to be going to the Undying Lands, or a promised land. That's the way it was described to me. So I'm a little confused on that, but they're playing it so fast and loose with the canon. There's a lot of different ways you can go with it.
Honestly. Yeah, the whole timeline's getting smashed together, and
there is some canonical stuff. But if it's going to be canonical, then Celeborn should be standing right next to her right now. So like that's the deal. She does separate from Celeborn later, but that's with her daughter. So they have gotten married and gotten on and had a kid. Now, I've gotten no confirmation that she has a kid in this yet. So we'll find out. But this is prior, I believe. I could be wrong. This is prior to her going to Numenor. And that's right. Galadriel goes to Numenor. And I can hear the people who've read the books going, no, she hasn't. She's never been to Numenor. We don't care. They don't care that Galadriel's never been to Numenor.
Doesn't matter to them.
She never went to Numenor. It's a fuck off.
They're writing the story that Tolkien never wrote.
Looks like expensive fantasy porn. I would watch expensive fantasy porn, Tony. I think all of us here would. I don't want to speak for everybody.
All the best parts are not going to be in this show.
Chris Gore prefers his high concept science fiction porn.
Yeah, I'm into that. This just look, Gary, just getting a cursory look at all this.
it just looks like generic fantasy show that uses elements that are very familiar, you know, in the world of fantasy, but what's the story? Who am I to, you know, who's the lead character? What's the, I don't know what's going, I feel confused is what I feel. So, and I'm not, and I'm not,
I really want to know from you. No, that's like, as somebody who's like not super duper into it, but like as a nerd, as a general nerd, like you would at least check in on this, right? Yeah, it looks really confusing because she's the star. Like you think you would open up on her, right?
Right. And like what her story is and why I'm supposed to care. It's unbelievable how like a really good film will make you care about a character quickly, right? Like, and just the one thing I did, like after the first teaser came out, the first thing I did was go watch the original trailer for Lord of the Rings, right? The first one. And I was like, holy shit, I want to see that movie. I didn't even like, as soon as I knew, like, it's like, that's a movie I got to see. Nothing about this screams any urgency, any story that resonates, or any sort of timeless storytelling. It just kind of, it seems like a corporation made this. And we know that that's true because this is why these corporate entities can't sustain with these franchises. I mean, look at what's happened to Star Wars. Look at what's currently happening with Marvel. We can talk about Thor if you want, because I've seen the movie now.
We will later. Yeah, I'm gonna ask you. Spoiler free. Yeah.
Later. But this, I just look at this and go, this is just a corporation. People hire. Whereas someone like a, you know, Peter Jackson, basically channeling, you know, the soul of Tolkien in the work and being so respectful, where, you know, he weighed every decision. And when you look at even the attention to detail, you pointed out, Gary, you pointed out the helmets looking 3D printed. That's the level of detail I expect. I mean, as much as like, I know I went on a rant about the IKEA chairs on the ship in Kenobi looking so cheap. It's not an unimportant detail. It's an important detail because it's so it shows how much you care. It so shows how much how important it is that, I mean, go back and just look at the orcs in the first Lord of the Rings, Peter Jackson, Lord of the Rings. You know, I mean, just like it's epic that fellowship, that first movie, and it built towards something. And again, I am not a super fan of Lord of the Rings or Tolkien or anything, and I love those movies. And when I hear the score, I get chills. Like,
yeah,
nothing about this. It feels so forced and corporate. And look at any entity on a certain time, you know, on a certain timeline, they just can't exist. It starts with a passionate individual wanting to say something, a la George Lucas in the early 70s, Gene Roddenberry, or a Peter Jackson who, being a fan and like understanding it, just go see any interview with Peter Jackson, read anything that he talked about during that era when he was making those films. Like, it was just he put his heart and soul into it. I mean, it's insane. I look at this and it's like, who's the heart and soul of this? It's lacks a heart and soul. You know, it just seems like, again, generic, forgettable. You know, and I'm someone who should be interested in this, doesn't interest me at all. And the thing about the Lord of the Rings, Peter Jackson series, it got people who didn't care about Lord of the Rings into it. I don't know what this is going to do. And a lot of people, you mentioned Prime having so many customers. Look, a lot of people that have Prime Video don't even know that they have it because they get Prime so they can get free shipping for crap they buy from Amazon. That's what most people do. Like, I'm buying crap from Amazon. I don't want to pay for postage. I'll pay your $100 a year, whatever it costs. And they have Prime automatically as part of their subscription, not even aware that they have it. And Prime is like a weird rabbit hole. You can find like weird, you can find movies like Robot Monster on there. And only you and I probably remember that movie from the 1950s, which was very dark and scared the crap out of me, even though it's a guy in a monkey suit with a, you know, a diver helmet. But
that's all, you know,
this exactly. But also the ending of that movie is super dark because he just destroys the world and he kills a young girl. That's a weird movie, Robot Monster. Deep cut. My apologies for the divert there from the main topic. But this just has a look of generic, like Also, everybody, I hate to say this, everybody looks way too freaking pretty, especially in this shot here. I know they're the elves. They are supposed to be pretty and whatever, but did she just walk out of a Sephora? And if you're married or have a girlfriend, you probably know what Sephora is. But or been forced to like I'm gonna go somewhere else while you're at Sephora. Anyways, again, generic fantasy show is written all over this without a compelling story to get me excited, you know, like. Even think of recent things, okay? The Man of Steel trailer. Whatever you think of the Man of Steel, set those feelings aside. The trailer for that movie and the music
is epic.
Epic. And also it's this young voice. He's talking to his, you know, adoptive father, played by Kevin Costner, Pa Kent. Like, those scenes, I get chills thinking about that trailer. I mean, look, mixed reaction, although I will say in hindsight, and I'll argue with Jeremy Griggs on this. I'll argue with Jeremy of G&G about this. You know, it holds up, this that movie. I look at the DC movies, I'm like, okay, the Marvel movies are kind of feel like TV movies now. And like, I look at the DC movies. Like,
that's such a perfect.
They were trying to be movies. The Marvel films got off to a decent start and then eventually just became episodes of TV shows. But yeah, I talked too long. My apologies.
No, you don't. No.
Go off.
Okay. I'm going to have to, talk to Chris after the show. I'm going to let you talk, dude. People here to hear your expertise. Please. And you're really a compelling speaker. I'm listening. I'm fine.
Yeah.
All right.
You can go on for hours if you want. Makes my job.
No, I can't do hours. No, I don't want to. I just don't. You're the Tolkien expert. I am not. I am a normie when it comes to it. And I'm also a fan of those movies. Yeah.
See that? No. Tell him, chat.
Hey,
there we go.
Hey,
tell him, chat. Like, this is Chris effing Gore here. He's a humble guy, but this is Chris fucking Gore. All right. We listen.
Yes.
Man knows what he's talking about.
But I've been around the sort of indie film scene, and you see like all indie film projects are motivated by passion. Peter Jackson began as an indie filmmaker. George Lucas is the most successful indie filmmaker of all time. And when you look at even a person like Christopher Nolan, he came from indie. Just like, there's something I want to say and I want to put it on film and I want it to be original and I want it to reach people and resonate and be meaningful and add something to their lives. And a lot of the stuff we see now, and I could mention most of the recent Marvel movies, I'd say most, not all, you know, like the Disney Plus series, 100% across the board. It's just more content and more just filling a slot with some agenda sort of woven into it, which nobody wants. And this is just the result of that. It's just this, it feels soulless.
Yes.
At best. Mm-hmm. It's soulless. You know?
And it has been. And it's this thing that, you know, that the fandoms that connected us all for so long, despite politics or where we put our junk or anything, the stuff that didn't matter until a few years ago, the fact that they just so without a care in the world, fucked something because of ignorance, but they can't claim ignorance anymore. That you could claim ignorance in 2016. I was understanding about that, but not anymore. Plenty of us have been telling you for plenty of time what you can do to succeed with the fandom. It's been a bunch of unsolicited and free advice that they have chosen to not only ignore, continue to double, triple, quadruple down on the bigotry and all that bullshit. And it's going to end with this. Now, the show itself could be a fart in the wind. It's certainly looking that way. Like, you know, I would tell
you, can't wait till it comes out, man.
Don't sleep on this one. Don't sleep on this one. Cause this is, if you want to get a point across, this will be the perfect way to do it because they are making every mistake Disney and Marvel and Star Trek and Doctor Who have already made years ago. It's like they're not even paying attention because they're not generally the Jeff Bezos and the producers and the higher ups. They don't watch any of this shit. They don't. They're busy with their meetings and their elitist lifestyles. It's the mid-level woke activists who are in control. The showrunners got the job because they were simply, they even admitted it. They had a pitch that Amazon liked with their, I'm paraphrasing what they said, but they, their willingness to listen to Amazon too. So they basically yeah. said, yeah, we'll fuck with Tolkien. You know, we'll stick to the lore until it doesn't, until it goes against our message. And the activists have been circling this franchise for decades before even this became a problem. They have been circling this franchise. That this has always been something that they, this has been kind of like their holy grail. So when, and we'll get to that article later. It's a great Bounding in the Comics article. By the way, hail John F. Trent. John F. Trent's a friend. I have no problem admitting that. He's such a good guy. We'll have him on soon. We're gonna get him on soon and chat with him, because he knows like what's happening with the fandom right now with Lord of the Rings is a giant white pill moment. And the fact that this trailer is hidden, and yes, hidden on Amazon Prime, is victory. It's a fucking victory. It's so cool. I was like, I was looking for it everywhere on YouTube. I'm like, where the fuck? Oh, they hit it, those little bitches. So good. And yeah, and no, Buzz Lightyear too. So I'm not a, you know, I'm an adult, so I'm not that in the toy store. I like the originals. They're really good. I took my kids to them. But like, yeah, Buzz Lightyear
happening there too. Yeah.
It's a massive white pill moment too. That's especially with Minions coming right out after it, and
yeah, just getting ass. Kicking its ass. I think you like you're totally right.
Movie
before in 2016.
Oh, cool.
In 2016, 17, 18, right? All this crap. They could be ignorant, and it was hubris. It was, we are never going to go out. We are on top of the world. We are the best. We can never make anything bad. And anybody that doesn't like what we make, they're idiots and racist, sexist, homophobes, right? And then after 2020. People just don't want to tune back in after they've been called racist, sexist, homophobes. And they're like, all right, well, screw you. I won't go to your Buzz Lightyear movie because right before you call me a dinosaur that's going to die off, I just won't buy your ticket. I won't watch this fake Lord of the Rings that you try to push on us with all this agenda in it. I just won't do it anymore. And they'll figure it out. And I think they're figuring it out right now. Whenever they released their trailer and their fan reaction, and it didn't get the reaction that they thought they were going to get, now they're hiding the trailer behind. They're only releasing the teaser on their own platform, kind of very, very kind of sequestered away from the public. Why would you not just release it? If you're so confident about the show, you spent so much money on it. You're so confident about the, you know, spending all this time focusing on new characters and the race and the sex of them. Why don't you put it out, huh?
That's a great point. And Chris brought up the best point of all. This is why we have him on the show, ladies and gentlemen. These new characters that they felt were so important, we don't know anything about them. All we know is Black Hobbit. Or, I'm sorry, Hobbit of Color.
Hobbit of Color.
Color. Numenorean of Color, which we'll get to.
Dwarf of Color.
We know. Yeah. That's all we fucking know. We don't even know anything about Galadriel other than the Vanity Fair article, which they've just repeated over and over again. She's full of pith and vinegar. She's got an orc body count equal to Conan. But let's watch the rest of the trailer. And I'll fill in to the Tolkien fans who have read the books and know a little bit about Tamriel. Yeah, they completely change her. And it basically turns into a buddy cop of Tamriel and Galadriel hunting orcs together.
Jesus.
Stop. Wait. That's guess who's coming to second breakfast. So those are two original characters. Now the young, oh no, what did she do to her face? She got fucking,
she don't look, yeah.
She was hot. Why did she do that? She did the cheek implant thing. Oh God, I hate it when they do that. So
there's a little lip in there too.
Counterpart, dude. She was good in Counterpart. But yeah, she's got like lip work and her face got longer. Yeah, I don't like it. Like, women don't do that.
Age gracefully.
It doesn't look good. It don't look good. So yeah, she was a Counterpart, and she was good in Counterpart. By the way, if you want to see a good, season two wasn't as good as season one, but if you want to see a good, like, super high concept sci-fi spy thriller with J.K. Simmons, like, at his very best, Counterpart. Good stuff. So yeah, these are two original characters that never come up in the Legendarium at all. So what we've seen so far is Prince Durin the Fourth, which is only, and I'm not sure on this one, but is only mentioned in a family tree in the appendices. And we've seen what, three original characters, and they're all looking at a flaming rock that is flying over. Okay, continue. They're very different.
Very Game of Thrones, by the way, flaming rock over the.
Oh, the yeah. Thrones. You mean the comet that everybody saw in season two?
Yep.
From A Clash of Kings? That was supposed to be kind of foreboding the prophecy of the prince that was promised, that gets kind of conflated with the coming of the White Walkers, and yeah.
It's very clear that Bezos was like, I want a Game of Thrones, damn it. Buy whatever fantasy property and try to make it Game of Thrones.
Yeah, if you guys remember from Game of Thrones season two, there, everybody's looking at a red comet.
Yeah. Wait, who's this?
That is Tar Miriel.
Oh.
That is the Numenorean queen regent who in canonically was supposed to be queen. Now, I will say that Numenoreans are descended from elves. Okay. But they certainly could be like the one race of people that, because they're seafaring, that went out and got busy. But then she wouldn't be Numenorean royalty. That could be debated, though. But whatever. She was supposed to be queen canonically. And then our Pharazôn forced himself on her to marry her so he can become king. And he's the one who brings the end of Numenor, right? So,
so are we going to see
destroy
Numenor? They're going to rewrite the history?
I'm going to spoil some of it for you. Okay. So, I don't know if it's our Pharazôn or not. That's the king. I don't know that. They could have just made up another king, and that king is supposedly in a coma or something. So that's why she's the queen regent. So she is ruling. She is indeed ruling. And Galadriel goes to Numenor. And again, I'm going off memory, so I'm probably going to get a couple of details wrong. I'm not too concerned about it because, I'm not a spoiler. I'm not a fucking scooper channel. This is just a very concerned person who loves Tolkien. I'm just saying, who loves Tolkien. So she is the ruler of Numenor. Galadriel meets her with the human. And I'm forgetting the human's name now. What's the human's name that she meets on the raft?
Oh, it's like a generic.
It's generic. It's
a generic fantasy name. Male name.
Another original character name. And they end up together on an adventure to go after, I believe, orcs, because Galadriel is indeed hunting for Sauron. She knows he's still out there, and she wants to avenge her brother and apparently her husband, but not as much because she only mentions him once in the entire fucking
not that series. Important.
So guess who's coming to Second Breakfast? The couple there, the elf of color and the girl from Counterpart. She has a son that's probably his son named Theo, or maybe not adopted, because he's half elf, by the way. Sorry, spoilers. The little kid is half elf. Another original character. He asks Galadriel later on in the season, he's like, have you lost somebody? And she said, yes, I've lost my brother and my husband. That's the only mention of Celeborn in the entire series.
My God.
In the entire series. So, yeah, kind of a big deal. I mean, Jesus. If you don't know the books, it's a big fucking deal. That's like a huge change. And we all knew what was going to happen, right? This is something you could, like, woke fucking storytelling is the easiest fucking thing to guess because, well, in the source material, if there was a white male involved, well, he'll be dead or gone.
Yeah. You know? It's like one of three things: dead, demeaned, diminished.
A woman can only have agency if the thing that is perceived to be more powerful is dead and gone or degraded, because Hollywood is, I mean, it's sexist. A woman is not degraded standing next to a man ever. I don't ever see it that way, but Hollywood obviously does. That's why they need to denigrate or kill all the white male. It's not just white males. It's males, by the way. It's all males. It's not just, I mean, you know, there is a bit of a bias towards the white male now, but they're doing it with all males now. And everybody's noticing it. And it's so fucking on the nose and obvious. So, yes, that is a queen regent of Numenor. And of course, that's just.
Yeah.
I guessed it.
Of course.
Go on. And that, oh, that was the crash. Go back.
And it's in a different
look. Gook use
What the explosion? What that was the
what? Okay, I'm starting to think that this is a laundering operation for Jeff Bezos' Coke habit. Okay.
They go to Fiverr and get some graphic designers to do this. Like, what is this?
What
I think fuck? You would get a better product if you went to Fiverr and said, hey, I need a little bit of VFX work. Could you do some?
Yeah,
I mean, a better product than this.
I know this is high fantasy and you must be high to think this is fantasy, but like, let's go to Tunguska. All right. It was a rock about the size of a VW van, and it blew up in the atmosphere and it leveled millions of square miles of forest.
This is like,
so anything coming in from space that hot is gonna fucking level everything. Fine. By the way, what that is that's the wizard landing. That's the wizard who, I'm just gonna guess, I could be completely wrong, is Gandalf. Okay, I'm just gonna,
yeah, who knows,
because he doesn't speak. I don't believe the entire season. What he needs to, the wizard needs to go somewhere. So they needed to like remake, you know, basically the Lord of the Rings, like the Force Awakens remade A New Hope. What, you know, it's like it's a requel. That's a term that the directors of Crank came up with when they did Ghost Rider: Spirits of Vengeance.
Oh, yeah.
People were asking, is this a prequel or sequel? And they're all, no, it's a requel. So that's what kind of this is. They needed something familiar for the normies. So the Second Age doesn't have any on the road stories, and that's what The Hobbit and The Lord of the Rings are. They are on the road stories. So they're gonna have female Frodo with a wizard, probably gonna be Gandalf. I could be wrong.
Could be Saruman, maybe.
It could be. Could be Radagast. It could be one of the blue wizards, whatever. I don't know, but I'm guessing Gandalf because they're just that on the fucking nose. I could be wrong about that. That's just a guess. And yes, the wizard doesn't speak, but it can, there's one part in the series where it takes fireflies and it creates a constellation to show that it needs to go somewhere. But, again, it's kind of, it's really, the wizard doesn't know how to act. Like, it's sometimes he helps, sometimes it's dangerous when he tries to help. So he almost kills a hobbit once by accident.
It's gonna be female Gandalf. Yeah.
I think it's a dude. I'm pretty sure it's a dude. Yeah, it's a dude because we see in the trailer there's like,
oh man, coming out. They missed the opportunity. Come on,
missed their opportunity for. Oh, they missed a lot of opportunities, especially like the bearded dwarves. Yeah. If they wanted to play with that like gender norms thing, but no, they didn't put a beard on the female dwarf, Disa. And it's gonna they're gonna talk about the Cimmerils a bit. They talk about Mithril. So there's no Sauron in the first season at all. They talk about him, but he's not in it. And the bad guy is not Galadriel's brother. It's just another elf. It's another elf who's leading a pack of orcs. That some are female. Some are female.
I think that's, is that everything in the
trailer? That's everything. That's it.
Yeah, that's everything. All.
That's it.
That's it.
That's it.
It was
like, it's another 50-second teaser.
It's a flaming
with repurposed.
Rock. It's a flaming footage. Rock flying over diversity.
Recognizing diversity as it goes.
It's clear they have nothing to offer. Chris, you pointed it out. Like, they should be taking one of these characters and going, this is their story.
Right.
In this trailer, right?
God, like, that first Lord of the Rings trailer, when you see Frodo and when you see Gandalf, it's just so like, oh, shit, I want to go on that journey. I want to experience that story. This is just like, again, like the first teaser looks like a PowerPoint that was put together. And you mentioned, Garrett, I love your observation. Like, they hired effects people from Fiverr. You know what I mean? Like, and I've used Fiverr too, but, you know, for YouTube stuff, like, who cares? Yeah. Right. Just for fun. But that's what you're getting. It just, nothing about it shows any story that would be compelling, that would hook me into the show. And there are, I mean, God, any number of like recent trailers or stories. Look at the trailer for The Northman, how like within seconds,
yes,
under a minute, you're wholly, I need to see that film. I need to, what happens with this character?
You know what the motivation is of the character. Absolutely.
Right.
It's beautiful.
You know the story. You don't know the whole story, but at least you know what the character is experiencing. There are, and this shows you when you're emphasizing elements like you mentioned, you know, diversity, right? Like, diversity doesn't make things good. It just doesn't. Diversity is great when it's organic. And it's been organic for years. It's not a new thing that woke Hollywood discovered. It was in Star Trek in 1966. Excuse my language. It's been around. It's not a new thing. It's not a new thing, kids. You didn't invent it. We can point to so much science fiction and fantasy and all this with diversity. Doesn't make things better. Show me a character whose story I can become engaged with, and the fact that they've avoided that tells me it may not be there. It's another case of checking off boxes. That's it. Yeah, look at that. I said it as the comment came up. Holy crap, Daniel. Sorry about that, Gary.
Daniel,
no, it's okay.
I get worked up.
Please continue to get worked up.
Can I read this one since he Daniel? Yeah. Yeah, Daniel for 100. The heart and soul of this is checking all the boxes. It's sacrilege. That excitement that all of us used to feel that Chris Gore is talking about, the weirdos feel that way about the casting ticks. I think Daniel's absolutely right. That. It's just like you're focused on the wrong thing. This is why something like a Lightyear fails, and something like Minions, which to me, I saw Minions. It's fine. It's disposable entertainment. There's absolutely zero woke about it. In fact, there's like a lot of really fun stuff about it. Like, Jean-Claude Van Damme plays like an evil character named Claw with a giant lobster claw. There's these sort of like these super villains, the Vicious Six, and they're funny. It's like it's and the Minions themselves, like, my daughter knows way more about it than I do, so she was filling me in. But like, it's fine. It's disposable entertainment. Had a good time watching it, and it's over in 90 minutes. And Lightyear, everything you could do wrong, right? It's like an hour 50. It's got this sort of like shoehorned in agenda stuff, which doesn't ruin the movie, but doesn't need to be there either, which could provoke a conversation with kids that may not be ready for, or a parent may not be interested in having that kind of conversation. You know, as you've raised kids, wait, this is the parent podcast. Part of this is
the dad stream.
All parent. The dad stream. This is the dad stream. So, you know, you got having uncomfortable conversations with kids, part of being a parent. And I choose when that happens, not a multi mega corporation choosing to weave things into my entertainment to force a conversation that my child may not be ready for, but they want to see the cartoon fun movie with the spaceman. You know what I mean? Like this is it's just freaking irritating. So thank you, Daniel, for the support. And this stuff, it's just so obvious, but it's like you've said, Gary, like, to pivot from this is gonna take so long it's just going to take years when you look at like how things get into development, how long it takes things to happen. And just also changing, I know this has come up before, you got changing the culture. Look at what a culture shift did to Pixar. When you get rid of the man who was the heart and soul of Pixar, John Lasseter, who goes off, who's going to do very well with Skydance, I believe. You know, and you change the culture, it changes the product, and you're ending up with something, and you're looking at people that, like, you know, this is a weird reference, but stick with me on this. There's a sketch on SNL. I haven't watched it in like 2 years, but there was a sketch on SNL from years ago that was very funny, where they bring out like a guy who is like, you know, does your lawn, or a guy who is the doorman. And they ask someone, all the question is, what's my name? What's my name? And I feel like, you know, people in these positions, they don't have any experience with real working people or just average moviegoers or whatever. And they see themselves as betters, and that affects the product. Mm-hmm. It affects the final result. And you know, Marvel, Kevin Feige, being smart about this aspect, was very wise to, for a lot of the films, pluck people from the world of indie film, because they know about having a vision, right? I mean, you look at like everyone from Taika Waititi to James Gunn to the couple that did Captain Marvel. Not great results on that, for sure. But a lot of the filmmakers come from indie. The other thing about indie too, you don't have to pay them as well. They'll be very excited to just be doing a Marvel movie and getting paid whatever they get paid.
Then get pushed around and told what to do easier.
They can also more easily get pushed around and told what to do, with the certain exceptions. I do think that they trust certain directors more, like Gunn or Taika. Mm-hmm. Got a little bit more free reign, and they also know, and I've seen people who have this talent where they know how to manipulate the people that are supposed to tell them what to do. For example, Quentin Tarantino tells a story about Harvey Weinstein came up with the idea to split Kill Bill into two movies, but basically Tarantino manipulated him to make him think it was his idea, because he didn't want to cut the movie. He wanted to make a 4-hour movie. No one's going to release a 4-hour movie, but if I convince Harvey Weinstein, you can split it into two movies. And Harvey likes to take credit for that being the idea, but it was Quentin. It was Quentin that kind of like planted the seeds of that. And I do think that like the better filmmakers, like a Chris Nolan, you know, a James Gunn, whatnot, they're very good at knowing how to tell the powers that be the things that they want to hear and make them feel special and important while doing whatever the fuck they want. You know what I mean?
I mean,
Chris Nolan's making a movie with pretty much only white people in it. I don't even know how you make that today, right?
How is that possible?
Right, a movie? Yeah.
So he's doing that right now. So how did he convince them? Look, is, you know, whatever. He told them what they out
and said, I'm Chris Nolan, bitch.
Yeah, exactly. But so all this stuff, it's like I see it because I've known people who've catapulted. Like, I knew James Gunn back in the 90s when he was at the St. Louis Film Festival working for Troma, and have, you know, watched his success. We communicate far less frequently now, so no surprise. But I still feel at his heart, even though he's kind of telling them what they want to hear, that like he's getting away with a lot more. So more than other filmmakers would, who like the filmmakers, and I forget their names, the filmmakers behind Captain Marvel, they were totally just, I think it was them being manipulated and kind of told what to do. And then Brie Larson just being herself. From what I know, she just doesn't seem very collaborative, you know, and filmmaking, I think when it's at its best, is a team sport. Right. Mm-hmm. But you know, you choose the members of the team. I think she's just miscast in that role. I think if Ronda Rousey was Captain Marvel, we'd be talking about, we can't wait for Captain Marvel 2.
Sackhoff.
Katie Sackhoff, I would say,
is way more just, like Carol Danvers.
Yeah, likability,
red carpet.
Yeah, just relatability. And Katie Sackhoff, compare her YouTube channel to Brie Larson.
She's got a great YouTube channel, by the way.
Yeah, I love it.
Cool. Yeah. So real quick, I want to. She would have been better. I want to address this because, I mean, you're not wrong. It's not the issue of Tar Muriel being there at all. That's not my issue. My issue is there is more male kings than female queens. There were there were actual female rulers of Numenor. But there's like four out of the over 20. So I just knew they would pick a female ruler. They would pick a time. We also need to discuss, like, that makes sense. Sure. Does it make sense that she leaves the island of Numenor to go fight with Galadriel and then get blinded later on? and then I guess then Ar-Pharazôn comes and takes the scepter after Tar-Palantir dies. Right. But this is years before the forging of the, you know, there's the downfall of Numenor, which is in 3319, right? So we're talking
Are you using dates?
I'm using
dates. Don't matter here to these people.
I know. So the entire second age is 3441 years. 3441 years downfall of Numenor. Wait, we need to go more here. It ends too soon. I'm going off of a list here because, my memory's not that good. But does it make sense to have her in the first part of the story with Galadriel? That's my issue. My issue is, why is Galadriel on fucking Numenor? Because they wanted to give her an adventure story that she never had. And the problem I have is, and I just always have to go back, is I conflate what's in the Silmarillion from what's in the appendices, right? We can't conflate what's in the Silmarillion because Amazon doesn't have the rights. So what they're doing is they're taking these big blank spots and they're just filling them in with whatever the fuck they want because the Tolkien estate has signed off on it. They because they don't give a shit.
Well, you Tolkien know? Never said.
Yeah.
That's
my issue. That's my issue. It's not the fact that she's in it. I don't even care that they have a Numenorean of color because I have argued from day one, like, that's the one race you could probably play with a little bit. That would totally make sense within what Tolkien has set up. That would be it's. But that wasn't enough. Remember the quote unquote Tolkien expert that came out and said, yes, there are places in the Legendarium that are diverse that you could have fit in and it would have made sense in the overall story. And you could have fit it in with Peter Jackson's Lord of the Rings, but they decided because again, it comes to importance. It comes to importance that to them, not to us, to them. See, they're the ones who put importance and put all the power in these power structures that they claim to hate, but they just want to usurp. And they being the, you know, general Marxist dipshits from the universities that call themselves scholars. And that's why we have, you know, Tolkien Society just going over the fucking deep end now and then putting their own personal politics and everything and going after us when we're saying, hey, just respect what the man has laid out in detail. That's all we've been saying. That's all we will say. I am completely understanding with some stuff, but this is going overboard, and it shows if they can't get the little things right, they're not going to give a shit about what Tolkien, again, has meticulously put together to the day he died.
Yeah. It's not like he thought all of this stuff out. The moons, phases, the dates, everything. There's a great documentary that was for the original trilogy, like whenever it came out, and it was talking about Tolkien, about how he sat down and he thought about all of this stuff because he wanted to know the world before he really finished the books. And now they're like, yeah, we'll just throw hundreds of years together and make it all kind of one area and willy-nilly throw everything, you just got right here and mix things up and add new characters. It's like, what? That is so against what he did in his works. And man, that podcast that we have in the video where she tried to justify changing Tolkien and saying this is so antithetical to everything that he was about. No, like changing his work, you don't change Tolkien's work. Whenever Tolkien was alive, they said he hated editors editing his work. What are you doing now, going back and changing and adding stuff and claiming that you're doing it because, oh, that's what Tolkien would love? No, he would not love that. He changed it himself. This was his thing. Like,
yeah. So again, the Second Age is, you know, 3,400 years. The forging of the Rings of Power happens about halfway through the Second Age, before Tar Miriel, 1,700 years before, roughly. I could be off, but it happens in the year 1,500 of the Second Age. So it happens way before. So in the show, that hasn't happened yet. That hasn't happened yet. So Sauron is, and the mystery in the first season is who's Sauron, because he still has his ability to shapeshift up until the fall of Numenor. So that's what the big, it's like, you know, by the way, that's a guess. That's just a guess. I don't know that for sure. But we're talking about events that when they say they're playing it fast and loose, they're taking something that happened 1,500 years prior and putting it later. All for, now, why did they do? The question is, why would you use Tar Miriel? It would make sense if you were just going to center your show around the fall of Numenor, which would be fine. I'd be fine with just a show about that. It's agenda. That was their reason. They're like, we need to put more women in Tolkien. So how can we do it? Well, we'll take an event that happens, you know, to 1,500 to 2,000 years later. We'll just put it before the other one. It won't matter to anybody, except it completely dismantles what the man put together. Right? So, and this is something any writer worth their salt will fucking talk about. But, you know, we hear from people like Kurtzman that canon is hard. Canon is difficult to work with. It sure is when you suck, when you're not a very good writer, when you're a fucking hack. And, you know, lo and behold, we have two fucking J.J. Abrams disciples working on this show, who Alex Kurtzman is one himself, doing the same shit. The same shit, like giving Spock a fucking foster sister that he never talked about. The same shit that's, you know, happening with Disney Star Wars, and Michelle Rejwan is there. She is definitely a creative force within Lucasfilm. She is a former Jar Jar Abrams assistant. So, like, you see where the poison comes from. That's where the poison comes from. And they don't care. They just simply don't care. And we do. And then they go, why do you care so much? Come, please pay for our streaming service. Let's read some super chats. So that's my, yeah, that it's the foundation of why, you know, Mahler talked about it yesterday. He's like, yeah, the writing ultimately sucks. And you're right. Like, it's all in the execution. But why is the writing suck? Why does the writing suck? Well, the writing sucks because they limit themselves, because they're like, well, we have to check all these boxes before we even write our story. And that, you know, nobody's asking for that. Nobody's asking for that. And by the way, it's making them take creative, quote unquote, chances that aren't smart. So, you know, like for instance, with Kenobi, did Reva need to be in that story at all? No, no. Did she need to be that? Okay, if she's going to be in it, did she need to be that important? No, it actually derailed the entire fucking story.
Yeah.
Yeah. And not only that, Reva, if George Lucas was doing the brilliance of George Lucas, I mean, on so many different things, but a thing that maybe go sort of unnoticed is his ability to give incredibly small amount of screen time to a character and make them super cool and huge. I mean, think of, like, you know, the bounty hunters on the deck of the Super Star Destroyer with Vader. That's when you see Boba Fett, or a character. And I know everyone in the chat is probably going to know who this is. And she probably had 3 seconds of screen time max.
Aura Singh. If you remember, Aura Singh had this cool look. She was a bounty hunter.
Oh, yeah. They popped her in there for a couple seconds.
A couple seconds, seen incredibly briefly in The Phantom Menace. Really short. They made a 12-inch action figure. They did all this.
Yeah.
Like, and she was cool, and you saw her briefly. When you look at Reva, I kind of feel like, well, what? I mean, I don't know. Aside from adding a robot arm and an eye patch, which is kind of cliche, like, what about her? She just looks like, I hate to say this, just on the surface, just bad cosplay, right? Mm-hmm. Like, yeah. I'm 100%. Sorry. It's just like, look, just like the helmets. And Gary, I think you should do a whole video about the helmets in the background of that shot, the 3D printed helmets. Because it's so right. The little details matter so much. And that's what made what George Lucas did. And he made it look easy. That's why JJ coming in is like, he's basically just photocopying Star Wars, and a bad photocopy that, well, we'll make the TIE fighters black, or just that's so fucking lazy. Anyways, there's not one new starship design that stands out from any of the sequel films. Anyways, but it's like those little details, the sort of brief screen, like filling the frame with so much cool shit that a character that has less than 5 seconds of screen time, Aura Singh, is turned into a whole thing where she can have a and also allow the audience, which is what very little fantasy work does now, is use your imagination. Things that happen off screen, things that are unexplained. Now things are over-explained because we assume the audience is stupid, which was the entire Kenobi show. The audience is stupid, whatever. Who cares about canon? Whatever. Like, you know, so like, I just feel like Lord of the Rings is going to be, you know, more of the same, or, you know, this Amazon series, whatever, corporate.
Dude, if they were smart, I think it's because they're not smart and they're bad writers. They felt like they needed characters to follow throughout the entire series. And what they should have done is either focused on one of the three major events of the Second Age, which is Fall of Numenor, Forging of the Rings of Power, and the fall of Aragorn, you got to roll that R, or the War of the Last Alliance, like right before Lord of the Rings. And or you could just do separate seasons where one is covering each of them, right? Or you can, you know, especially the War of the Last Alliance and everything leading up to it. That could be two seasons, right? But no, they needed to have Galadriel in everything. So they're like, you know, we're going to respect the lore, except for the timeline, the characters, the characterization, the messaging, and basically everything Tolkien put in.
But the name says Lord of the Rings, guys, so don't even think about anything after that.
Yeah. So, okay. Just the War of the Last Alliance would be enough. It ends tragically. It would lead right into Lord of the Rings, but you couldn't have Galadriel in it. Okay.
That's why I'm so against any company making a franchise that people love, because at this point right now, like Chris was saying, they're just not putting the heart into it. There's no heart into it. I want to go back to this, watching the documentary about the original Lord of the Rings trilogy and how they did the costumes, like Sauron. There's internal like cloth that has patterns on there, and she specifically said this isn't going to show up on screen, but it adds to the character. There's texture, there's depth. The gauntlet that Aragorn has, he gets it from Boromir, and there's like the tree of Gondor, and there's all this little stuff in it. It's so detailed that you're never gonna pick up, like with a first viewing, but it's there because they cared so much. And this, like you said, like that helmet, it just looks bland as shit. There's no heart into it. And I know that they pulled Weta in, but I'm like, at what point did they pull in Weta? Because they didn't have him early on in the production.
I think they have now. Specific things, you know, because I think the orcs look okay, you know, and Weta's done great work. Nobody's gonna deny that. They're fucking fantastic at what they do.
That's what I'm questioning. I'm like, did they do these main costumes? Because the main costumes, they just don't feel like Weta had the heart into it.
Aelmir's helmet downstairs. It's fucking awesome. They did
amazing. Yeah, they're amazing.
It's awesome.
They put so much thought into the history of the objects and not just the look of them. So it just the amount of heart that was in it before and is completely devoid. The same thing happened to every one of the other franchises. Star Wars, they took the same ingredients of Star Wars and then mixed it around. And then, like you said, Chris, none of the ships are memorable. In Star Wars, every single time you had a new Star Wars came out, there was like five new memorable ships that came out of that. And that's just the ship. That's not talking about weaponry or costuming or any of that. That's just the ships. And now, can you pull one ship out of any of the Disney Star Wars movies? No.
Look at any Disney Star Wars. They're bland, they're boring, and not just memorable, Garrett.
They blew it up.
They're so simple. The shapes of the ships are so simple.
Yeah.
A five-year-old can draw them. When I was a kid, I was drawn Star Wars ships, like every kid when Star Wars came out that summer. Because you could draw them because they were simply shaped. And George Lucas understand that.
The design.
I mean, and I don't even know if people know, but like the Millennium Falcon, the shape of the Millennium Falcon was based on a hamburger because George Lucas loves cheeseburgers, right? He loves to eat hamburgers. He was famously at Hamburger Hamlet, which used to be across the street from the what was the Man Chinese Theater, now the TCL Chinese whatever. And he was there. It was based on a hamburger, the shape of a hamburger. It was just like
Chinese simple things out of life. Own What's the that? Chinese theater? That do the Chinese own the Chinese theater?
Yes, yeah. I believe they do. I think TCL.
Shit! Who's the guy? You might know his name. I met him, and I feel bad. I can't remember his name. Mm. He designed the Orville ships and the Battlestar Galactica ships. I'm forgetting his.
Ralph McQuarrie? Ralph McQuarrie? Or no? Was Sid Mead?
That's Star Wars.
No. This guy's like still alive. I met him like a couple years ago. So he was a ship designer.
I really liked
that guy. He was like,
yes.
You know, he had all his little BSG ships and at his desk, and it was a holy shit. Just looking at that stuff, my fucking jaw was on the ground. I'm kind of
even those ships. I mean, you're looking at all levels, the detail oriented design. It's all based on stuff from the past, not based on people who actually studied architecture or design and also if you played the X-Wing game, the old school X-Wing game, there were rules about those ships that were thought out that fit into the game it's so brilliant in its simplicity, and that can't be captured. I just think that there's really two kinds of writers. In my experience, there are the brilliant writers that are just born to be a writer. You know, your people like a Stephen King or other people who work in film that just they're born to be writers. And then I hate to say this, that most writers develop, they're older. To me, the better writers are just older because they've had life experience. They've had love. They've experienced love and loss. They've had children. They've experienced a lot of failure. And they've taken that life experience and it comes out in the writing. And I hate to say this, there are a lot of young, inexperienced writers being brought up into the entertainment industry today that come from no life experience, but they've watched a lot of shit. And that's no replacement.
Yeah.
That's no replacement for life experience. That's no replacement for feeling real pain, not, you know, pain via you watched a movie, right? Like, real life experiences, you know, when you and you know it when you see it, you know, when you say you read the work of Charles Bukowski, you know, or something like that, which I think everybody goes through a Bukowski phase, usually in college, but you know, I just see a lot of writers now, they're just inexperienced and they don't have life experience. They have experience, they've watched all the Star Wars movies. Well, that's not enough.
That's not experience. Yeah, that's not experience. Always kind of, noticed this in writing, is it definitely seems like the writers Doug seen all this stuff.
Drexler.
Doug Drexler.
The designer.
Yeah.
Nice.
Drexler. Yeah.
The writers seem to have watched all this stuff. They go, I love the moment whenever Han Solo comes in at the last second and saves Luke Skywalker. I love the way I feel whenever I watch that. And then they make a movie, but they don't have any of the context of the lead up or the meaning behind that or like why it makes people feel that way. They just go, I like the way I feel whenever that happens. So let's make a movie with that. Let's drop in a fucking billion ships at the end of Star Wars Rise of Skywalker, because that's the same thing that happened before. And I remember that beat, and that's going to make people feel the same way. No, it's not, because it's hollow. And so many other types of those kind of like the moments that movies and film can make you feel, they're retreaded by these new writers, but they don't understand why those moments make you feel that way and how to execute it in the right way. And they just go, I want that moment in my thing. And it just feels hollow.
Because it is. It feels hollow because it is. And yes, Sauron had a physical form and he can shapeshift prior to Numenor. Then he would get his physical form back and then he would get destroyed again. And it was never really... he got his physical form back because Gollum described his finger, you know, as missing when he was being tortured. Mm-hmm. Gollum ate babies.
He did.
He did. Probably orc babies, but because there were female orcs.
It's like a modern day celebrity.
Yep. I'm pretty sure it was Doug. Like, I'm like, I think his name was Doug, because the guy was younger. Like, it wasn't Sid Mead. I would have known if I met Sid Mead or Ralph McQuarrie, because I would have shit my pants. But it was pretty sure it was Doug Drexler, because he's an artist and conceptual designer, and the conceptual artists at Orville were like the best of the best. They weren't like fucking Rings of Power dipshits. They were like, I got to see some of their original work like plastered all over the wall. It's fucking amazing. Before we get into Thor, let's read some soupy doopies.
It's 10 till 2, by the way. Just
okay. We're going to get into Thor for like 20 minutes and we're going to go. But thanks again, Daniel, for the $100, buddy. Bones 8. For $50 says, just wanted to thank you for continuing to be a voice and keep fighting the good fight. Hey, thank you very much. And like, again, we're just fans, you know. Chris been a fan of stuff all his life. I've been a fan of stuff all my life. And you know, like, we can't gatekeep shit. We're just giving our opinion and it continues to be ignored and they fight us, which is like just mind-boggling at this point. So don't be surprised when most of us are like, okay, fine, burn, we'll just watch you burn and we'll make fun of you in the process, because we tried for years. It's not like we weren't fucking patient, because most of us were really patient. A lot of people have just bailed out of the fight, and like that's I'm talking about content creators, and that's their prerogative to do. That's fine. Whatever they feel is best for them, they need to do. I still think there's a lot more to say and a lot more to cover and a lot more to do. And I think the ones who have stayed have been proven right, because it's starting to topple. And, you know, every time, say, a Marvel movie comes out and does $300 million in its first weekend, it sets things back a little bit. But I think we're gonna see the last of big weekends, like uber big weekends with Thor. I think that might be the last one for a while. I don't think Ant-Man's gonna bring in an Uber. I don't think Wakanda Forever is gonna bring in the weekend that Disney thinks it's gonna bring in. Marvel's will not. I predict that will be a flop, just like the Eternals was a total fucking flop. I just think it's happening. That was trending on Twitter. I don't know why, but
you're trending.
No, it's happening. Was trending. On it's Twitter. Happening. It's happening. It's happening. Yeah. No, I won't. I'm not going to trend on Twitter ever. That's fine.
I hate
Brian. fuck Twitter. Yeah. For $50 says it hasn't been since a Dr. Womb that I looked forward to not watching a show as much as I'm not looking forward to not watching Lord of the Rings, the Rings of Prime. P.S. I have Prime and I'm still not watching this. Yeah. Yeah. You can watch Terminal List. Everybody's liking that.
Yeah. People keep telling me to watch it.
Yeah. Everybody's liking that. So. Daniel for $25 says, is Taika Waititi the new M. Night Shyamalan? The guy has seemed creative, a guy that seemed creative and independent from the studios, who came in strong, then puttered out when everyone learned that they were a one-trick pony. Maybe. I think that's a segue for Chris to do a little spoiler free, because I doubt you could talk about spoilers, but because you saw it, or
I just think it's respectful to not like until enough people have seen it.
Yeah.
I mean, I'll talk about spoilers on Friday, and I'm sure you should do it on FNT for sure because you can see it Thursday and Friday. But
yeah, I'm seeing it tomorrow. Already,
three, yeah,
I think yeah,
it's predicted to make opening weekend 140 to 160. That's the numbers.
That's down from 180.
Yeah. So that's what the Ankler is reporting are the estimates.
Okay.
But look, here's the issue. And just to dispel a couple things. One, the thing that I think people liked about Thor Ragnarok was the humor. And I feel like it was, you know, maybe a little too much for some, whatever. But based on the fact that the events are very serious in Ragnarok, and then, but the humor kind of balanced it out, right? In this, Taika Waititi goes like full, it's just full comedy. And what I think bothered me about it is it makes any of the serious events just seem unimportant. So it's like nothing in the film that happens matters because it's just a setup. Even the dramatic events are just a setup for a joke.
Oh, right? Wow.
Exactly. So the one thing is, I will say this, I had expected Jane Foster Thor, which it bothers me that she's called Thor. Like, am I the only, and I have not read the
No,
you are not the only one.
No. Like, go back and watch all the comic videos from 2014 from when it came out.
I mean, I just think that's I don't know, give her a different name or whatever. But like, I will say this is I had expected, you know, Chris Hemsworth Thor to be overshadowed by Jane Foster Thor and Valkyrie. And that's not the case. It's kind of a bait and switch in the marketing with, the woman from the James Bond movie where they kind of made it look like that was going to happen and it didn't really happen. It's kind of like that. And it didn't bother me that much. And I will say Valkyrie, it seems like Valkyrie maybe was set up to have a bigger part and they cut a lot. On the positive side, the movie is like an hour and 59 minutes, which I'm really surprised in the age of like every movie's got to be 2 hours and 20 minutes or 2.5 hours or Eternals, 2 hours and 40 minutes. So the female characters do not overshadow, and actually they're good comedic moments between the two of them. The thing that ruins the movie is Taika Waititi getting in the way of his own movie, which is why it's getting mixed reviews from the mainstream press, is because some really serious things happen in the film. Gary, I think you already know what they are, and I don't want to bring it up, but there's some serious things that occur, and it feels like when I walked out of it, my first thought was, it's just another episode of a Thor TV show. Thor, it's just going to be another Thor TV show. You know, there's going to be another. So it feels like nothing matters. It feels like the stakes are, this is the villain of the week. And Christian Bale is actually really interesting as the gore character. If I might say it myself, if I say so myself. But it's
as a fellow gore yourself.
As a fellow gore spelled whatever. It's just, it's like, okay, and I walked out going, I think it's really superhero fatigue more than anything is that's
the big thing. It's also parts of the movie were shot in the volume and it feels like it. There's something about it that's sort of like, I mean, it's better than Kenobi. Kenobi might be the worst use of that new filmmaking tool ever. It was just terrible.
It's a lazy use of it.
Yeah. It was lazy use of it. In this, it was just like, okay, this is better, but it still feels like you're on a set and you see a vista. And they used to do, this is not a new tool. It's just that rather than just painting a background like they did in the 1930s with the Wizard of Oz, you know, which is what they did. They just like, it looks like a vista. It looks like it goes on forever. It's just a painted background. It's a digital background. So the actors, and also what's great about that, boom, you can click a button and you can change it to something else. You can make changes on the fly, whatever. Filmmakers love it. I just don't know that it has the effect that they intend. And parts of it feel like, oh, this was shot in the volume. This is another thing shot in the volume. Yeah. But I just walked out going like, eh, meh. It's just like, it's lacking that emotional connection. Also, I'll confirm one thing. This isn't necessarily a spoiler, but I'll confirm something. There is nothing in here leading to anything. Meaning there's no overall story. There's no tease of like, you know, a Thanos, there's no like, what is the point of Phase 4 other than to introduce, you know, all these all new Marvel characters?
Continue to exist. Phase 4.
Yeah. Consume Marvel product. That's what it feels like.
Yeah.
And look, the saving grace of the movie is Taika Waititi, I like him. I like him as a filmmaker. I think that like maybe Taika Waititi Unleashed is not the best. And I would compare it to something like David Lynch, for example. David Lynch, when he was able to do whatever the hell he wanted, you ended up with movies that weren't particularly accessible and kind of just like bizarre for bizarre sake. But the Twin Peaks, when he had to follow all those sort of corporate rules, he just looked for ways to get around those rules. And at least the first season of Twin Peaks is freaking brilliant, you know, but he was under these rules and was just looking for ways to get around it. And this is sort of like they just said to Taika, do whatever you want. I think the goats are kind of entertaining. He gets these goats and it's just kind of funny because of the way they sound. But at the end, I'm just like, I walk out and I kind of feel like, what's the point? Whereas you look at other films such as The Dark Knight, we're still talking about that movie from 2008, right? You know, 14 years later, we're talking about that movie. You know, what is it about this that we're going to be talking about 14 years later? We're not going to. No, we're not going to talk about this movie four years later or even 2 years later. We just
MCU products.
It's not building on any larger story. It's the continuation of the humiliation of Thor. If you're into that, I'm not.
The Guardians treat him like shit, right? Like they're in the beginning.
Yeah, well, they're just sort of like tolerating his, you know, his arrogance and narcissism, and I think that's kind of, I like the Guardians. I thought that aspect kind of worked, and then they're gone, and then they're really in the movie fairly briefly as a handoff. But again, I'm just left feeling, what's the point? Why does this movie matter? And it doesn't. And they may as well have just put this on Disney Plus. And I'm not saying it's bad, right? And I think this is worse, Gary. This is worse. If something is bad, you can roast it, have fun with it, whatever. Or if something's great, we can talk about how great it is, right? With something like a Top Gun or whatever. Like, we're still thinking about Top Gun. And I've seen it 3 times in the theater. And before it leaves theaters, I need to see it one more time in IMAX. But it doesn't, it's just sort of meh. And I think that's the worst kind of entertainment, is something that's just middling. It's not memorable. It doesn't make you think about larger things. It doesn't lead to conversation other than, well, that was okay. And so it being, and this is why you're seeing, I think that the critics rating is like, is it 71% on RT?
Yeah, 71.
Right, about that. So that to me is accurate. I'd rate it a little bit lower, but you know, these don't feel like movies anymore. They feel like episodes of TV shows, because
it can't lead to anything. It just, I mean, what are you going to do now? You know, you've killed everyone around Thor, his brother, his mother, his father. What else? Yeah. 71%.
What else you got?
But I will say this, audience score, I expect to be higher. I think that the 140 estimate is probably accurate.
Yeah.
This is better than Doctor Strange and the Multiverse of Madness. It was a mess. That movie was a mess. And I would say, if you count Spider-Man, you know, the latest Spider-Man as part of the MCU, I'd probably say it's the second best film of Phase 4, but the bar is really low. The bar is low. And then
it was very, very low. Yeah,
so I ask, what's the point? Where is this leading? Is there some other, this is the thing that made at least the TV or serialized, if you look at Marvel as just like this ongoing story, the thing that made it interesting was Infinity Stones. It was leading to this. I mean, I guess the only thing we've seen is that could be comparable are bracelets. You've got the bracelet in Ms. Marvel. You've got Shang-Chi and the bracelets of power.
And
Shang-Chi and the, I don't know. Bracelets.
And the legend of 10 bracelets.
Yet another fashion accessory is the only thing driving this, but there's nothing. There was that, you know, post-credit scene at the end of Shang-Chi with Captain Marvel and Bruce Banner and okay. And there's none of that. I feel like they don't know where they're leading.
Well, I think it would be
this Marvel has clandestine in it. I've always called it clandestine, but it's probably clandestine. Which is kind of a deep cut, an X-Men deep cut.
It would be cool
connected to the X-Men or not.
And it would be cool if this phase like just didn't set anything up, and it made you think that it wasn't setting anything up. And then in the last movie, it went, oh, drop something big, and throughout all of the phase that you thought was just not setting anything up, it was really actually setting up the X-Men coming in or something. But I don't think they're smart enough for that.
No. Russo came out and said that they do not have a plan. Like, and that was obvious with Endgame. Because Endgame,
they're done.
It's not like two different fucking movies with that. There is so much footage from the cutting room floor from Endgame. They could probably make another fucking movie.
Maybe they should. They could do some supercut or whatever. But it just sort of, again, you know, earlier in our conversation, talked about soulless corporate content like that this kind of just feels like that. I kind of feel like Marvel is like, and what is the, where's this leading? What's the point? I don't know how well Ms. Marvel's doing. I saw the first two episodes and just, I kind of felt just like Ryan Connell, like this, it's not, you know, it's just not for me.
It's not doing well, by the way, I can't verify it with numbers, but it's not doing well.
There you go.
I've heard from people it's not doing well. It's not being watched by a lot of people. And that's probably because they buried it under Kenobi, and then the season finale is going to be buried behind Thor.
Yeah,
meant to do.
But I will say this. It's just like, I think mainstream audiences, your normies are going to go to Thor and say, that's fun. I had a good time. And they will forget it in a week and they won't care. I think you're going to see a huge drop off in the second weekend. And the other thing that people have been talking about is Hollywood has a problem now with the third quarter. There are no huge event tentpole movies. I mean, Nope, if you consider that one, or Bullet Train in August, but man, the next 3 months are going to be a slog. So just get ready. The third quarter, you've got Thor, Nope, and Bullet Train. And that's it. Like, this is, and the thing is people are still going to theaters. It's crazy. I mean, look, I went and saw Minions. It's
almost like February stuff.
Yeah, it's like February. Like, what is this? Like, look, there's a lot of good indie stuff. There's always decent indie stuff coming out, and that's fine. But that stuff is small and a narrow audience. Look, having done Film Threat for years, I can just tell you, it's like, this is a small audience. It's a small audience. And occasionally one of those movies breaks out, and that's fine. It's fun when that happens, you know, but like, it's rare. You know, like a movie like Marcel the Shell with Shoes On, which is a stop motion animated movie.
The bigger stuff is on TV.
Yeah, the bigger stuff is. You're right. Yeah, Stranger Things.
Holy yeah. shit, Stranger Things. Like Stranger Things I just watched the biggest amazing
thing this year, probably, and Top Gun. And then in the fall, I mean, Rings of Power and House of the Dragon are coming out like right at the same time.
Yeah.
That should be big. Now, that those could, again, be farts in the wind, and I wouldn't be upset or anything. That just could happen. But those are bigger than any of the fucking movies coming out. And then what do we have? Avatar. Avatar is coming at the end of the year.
Woo.
Wait, did you hear it might be 3 hours?
Yeah.
Like the rumor is it's going to be long. Oh, and quick, Gary. I saw like the first two episodes of season 4 of Stranger Things, and it made me angry for two reasons. One, it's so good. It's so good. It's just such a good. And the actors in it, who most are children, right? Really good child actors. It felt big, you know, it's in a high school, they're big scenes. It felt like everything that happened was important and mattered. Every line, every event, every clue. And so I've just finished watching Kenobi, right? Now pivoting to Stranger Things season 4. I mean, what the hell? Kenobi, they should be apologizing. It's like night and day. Apologize. It is like night and day. It's like they should
Why
be apologizing.
Apologize when you can call everybody a bigot, Chris.
Yeah,
it's so much easier.
That's disgusting to me. The fact that their marketing strategy is to alienate fans. Also, by the way, Stranger Things, a very diverse cast. Diverse. Yeah. There are female characters that are very important. There are non-white characters, and guess what? Nobody gives a fuck. They're interesting characters. No one cares. No one cares. And the acting,
and the girl that played Max was
fantastic.
And
the writers know damn well that people didn't like the last two seasons. And instead of fucking whining about it, they just like, okay, we'll do better.
Yeah.
And they did
better.
Just did better.
And they did.
Just
wrote, they did. You know? I'm hooked. And it was you, Gary, that actually motivated me to watch it. But in contrast to Kenobi, holy shit. Like,
it's a fucking joke.
It's a joke. Kathleen Kennedy shouldn't produce saliva, much less movies.
Oh no.
It's like a preschool play. Like whenever you look at Kenobi, it's just so poorly done.
So what you're saying is Thor is meh, okay, which is a defeat in itself, because you're wasting like a legacy MCU character that quite frankly Disney did not start. And you know, it's logical to give Taika Waititi creative freedom, but how much creative, like, was it his idea? It might have been, considering that he's like Stupinger, to make King Valkyrie instead of Queen Valkyrie. Cause like that is so cringe on every level, That is I don't care that she's in it for a minute. For one, again, Valkyrie is, I'm the only one bitching about this. One of my favorite characters from the comics. This is not fucking Valkyrie at all. There's nothing Valkyrie about this one.
This is your Monica Rambeau. Eric July was like, Monica Rambeau, they fucked her up. Damn it.
Yep.
You're like, so Valkyrie.
Valkyrie's the hill I'm going to die on. Tessa Thompson's one of the worst actresses from Hollywood. She's just favorite actress of color right now. And she's in like, she showed up in Westworld again. And it just, the quality dipped. So, I mean, it was
already, man, that's pretty low.
To begin with, but I mean, I was like, oh, like in the first episode of Westworld season 2, you can tell they were trying. The problem is like Jonathan Nolan's not there. Mm. Like if he's not there, it's not going to be good. That guy's a good writer. He's a good writer, but the quality of Westworld goes with Jonathan, and he like dipped out of the show. In season,
he's off doing another show, right?
Yeah. Well, him and Lisa Joy signed a contract with Amazon, so they're just they farmed out Westworld, and it's just boring as fuck. It's so boring. Tessa Thompson, not my favorite actress, and even worse in one of my favorite comic characters. I really need to hear Gary's thoughts on Gavin Newsom running ads in Florida, telling them they are not free. That's Gavin Newsom like owning himself. That's the ultimate fucking self own. If there's a comic convention in Florida, hypothetically, do I have to show a vaccination pass or do I have to get a rapid test or wear a mask? The answer is no. The answer is no. Do I have to do that here in Texas? No, but I have to do that in California. I have to, after all of the science, after all of the data that we know that this is endemic, that we have to just live with it. Like people have been saying from the fucking beginning, by the way, it's less potent now and you're going to survive, especially if you're going to get the poke. But I digress. Yeah, fuck Gavin Newsom.
Man, I can't wait to get some of that tent city freedom that Gavin Newsom's given out.
Yeah, yeah.
Wouldn't that be great?
I mean,
yeah.
You're free to get a tent and a needle and to live under a bridge amongst your own feces. So
yeah, that sounds fantastic. Yeah,
you can do that. Why don't you ask Gavin Newsom this if he's going to run for president? Ask him two fucking questions. Was he following his own rules, which you can get him on? And where was his staff vacationing while businesses were shut down, including my wife's? Fucking Florida at Disney World. They got caught. So that's what I would do. I would just DeSantis. I would run a counter commercial just going, yeah, all his people were vacationing in Florida during the lockdown. The lockdown, by the way, the mask mandates that ended March of this year, just a few months ago, a couple of months ago.
Insane. He just needs to be called out for that bullshit. I'll say this. I used to respect, you know, papers like the LA Weekly and the LA Times. Neither of those outlets has asked a challenging question of Gavin Newsom during the entire these last few years. No questioning whatsoever, not doing their job. I remember the LA Weekly was, I mean, every big city has its alternative paper, which writes the kind of, you know, at least attempts at journalism, maybe not with the budget of the LA Times, but they attempted nothing compliant press release, you know, just basically regurgitating press releases as news. It's bullshit. The LA Times is a garbage media outlet now that questions nothing, that doesn't, I mean, where are the journalists that you know, would ask the tough questions of Newsom? Who's in Montana right now, by the way? He's in Montana on vacation with his family.
Why would he be in Montana?
Not California. He's not in San Francisco. Exactly.
He's not in Yosemite. I mean, there's plenty of beautiful places to vacation. Yeah. California. Why would you?
Oh, why would you need to leave
there? Probably because he owns property there. Gavin Newsom's a prick. Gavin Newsom slept with his campaign manager's wife. He's a dick. The guy's a fucking dick. He's never debated anybody for any of his office. Somebody pointed this out on Twitter, and I'm sorry, I can't remember your name. The only time he's ever really been in a debate was with Adam Carolla back in 2013. He got his ass handed to him.
Oh, I remember that.
Ass handed to him. So yeah, if he will get destroyed in any debate, and plus the guy's got way too many fucking skeletons in his closet. He was anointed by Willie Brown, the same person who anointed Kamala Harris. And there was supposedly a backroom deal that she would be the vice president candidate if he could get the governorship or some shit like that. So, you know, yeah, California politics, they're fucked. By the way, Gavin Newsom, who could have been recalled, but then, you know, all of a sudden, mail-in ballots were the law of the land. And it was a landslide. It was really weird. Really strange.
Yeah.
Project done poorly for $20. Georgia Guidestones got bombed. Heck yeah. Yeah. Anything that says we should keep the population under 500 million.
Fuck that.
By the way, walk around New Mexico. Now go outside of Albuquerque about an hour and tell me about overpopulation. Fucking walk around this state. Get outside of San Antonio for about an hour and tell me about overpopulation. Please. Please. Hail Gary, thank you for keeping me entertained daily. Something all of them streaming services can't do, says Janan Klassen for 5 Canadian pesos. Thank you. I appreciate that. And you're welcome. I just drink coffee and talk. I'm entertainment must just be in a really bad way right now. that's what we're going to do. We're going to entertain each other. You know, I was listening to this morning when I was at the gym, I was listening to live streams. That's what I do. John Thomas for $5. By the way, this is a great channel. If you want to like your Lord of the Rings starter kit, Men of the West. Gary, did you see the Men of the West video? What if Sauron regained the ring? I haven't seen that one yet. But if you want to know about the kings of Numenor, Galadriel, and you don't want to read, although I would just say read the books. But if you want a little starter to get you enticed, go to Men of the West. It's not a channel that gets involved in the culture war shit. It's really stayed out of it, stayed out of calling other channels, pejoratives, and just does the lore thing and does it well. Nerd Cookies does that too. Check out Nerd Cookies. She does a good job with that too. Chris motherfucking Gore, speak. We love you, says Eric K. There you go.
Oh, thanks. Thanks, Eric. Awesome.
Late art for 100 Czechoslovakian pesos. Will they hide the whole show too?
Hopefully, if we're lucky.
Maybe. Hashtag respect the lore, says European lore, for 100 Czechoslovakian pesos. Subscribe to that channel. Subscribe to that channel. You want to subscribe to George the Giant Slayer, Lady Gravemaster, Disparu, and European Lore. If you want a suggestion of some good channels that I've been watching, those are the channels I watch. European Lore has been all over Amazon. It's beautiful. Good guy, smart guy. Dino's reviews for 179 says, pretty sure the comic contains a wizard. It does. It does. That's the wizard. Absolutely. So, and we read that one already. So it's not, I want to make it abundantly clear. There are some characters that are from the books that I have no problem being in the show if it was in context. If it was in context. As far as what that, I'm not going to get my panties in a bunch over what a Numenorean looks like, especially if it's somebody who's going to end up, sorry, spoilers, dead. But it does become a bit of a problem when you get into the lineage of, say, Aragorn. that's going to be a problem, right? Or the lineage of Arwen. I was only half joking because I'm pretty sure I can't say that. I think they might bring Celeborn back. I've been gone for 1,000 years after a war, honey. I'm back. I just went out to go get milk or what. Like, it's going to be stupid as fuck, right? But then it's going to be, it's going to look like Lenny Henry or Whoopi Goldberg or what. That's, I jest, but I don't. So what they're doing is they're mixing up the whole Fall of Numenor, and they're having it happen prior to the forging of the rings. Those are 1500 years apart in the wrong order. In the wrong order, which fundamentally fucks up your entire story if you cared about it at all, which they obviously don't. That's why they're hiding the material. That's why they're hiding the story. That's why they've come out with 4 teasers and commercials, but haven't given us a proper trailer, because they know they fucked up. What Chris said, Peter Jackson, you can tell they knew early on, like, we got some good shit here. Mm-hmm. We're watching the dailies every day. All these actors like love each other like family. Ian McKellen is like grandpa, and he's like taking everybody under his wing and just being this great guy. And they're like, we've got something here. At least we feel it. So we're going to fucking release a trailer 2 years early. Fuck it. We're feeling so good about this. That's confidence. That's confidence in your work. And plus, hey, we're dumping a bunch of fucking money in this. We need to get the word out now that we got this thing coming. And quite frankly, nobody knew what to expect with Peter Jackson's Lord of the Rings. I'll tell you what my expectations were when I saw a couple of the trailers. I saw the effects that weren't finished, and I'm like, okay, well, this will probably be like a really good sci-fi movie that, it's something. And, I've been wanting to see this forever since I was a kid, since I watched that little Hobbit cartoon on national television, by the way. But then when I walked out of that movie, I felt the same way I felt when I saw Star Wars, Raiders of the Lost Ark, Blade Runner, Back to the Future. It's like Ghostbusters. I was like, I just saw something. I just saw a classic. I just saw an all-time classic.
Something special.
Yep. I wanted to like turn right around and get back in that theater. I went the next day, but yeah. And you saw people who weren't into fantasy getting into it. And that was, you see this. Yeah. It just looks like the shit we're getting from Disney Plus. And they know it. So what do they have left? Instead of going, listen, coming out and going, I think OneRing.net tried to come out and says that most shows don't get good until the third season. Bullshit. Game of Thrones with people in the first season, in the very first season.
The first episode,
right? You know, ended badly, but they hooked people in and they were good. They were good for a little while. Four tries at Thor and still no attempts to adapt anything from Simonson's run. I know. Even the worst X-Men films paid tribute to Claremont. I know. Thank you, Big Viz 497 for $5. You're absolutely correct. If people haven't read, I mean, this is a great time to go read Thor comics. The back issues are cheap. They're not like uber collectible. And dig them up and read them, especially go and get the deep cut. Now these are collectible and a little expensive. So get the trades of Kirby it's Stan Lee and Kirby, but it's Kirby. Okay. Jay Lynn Moore says it's not so much about the lack of life experience. It's more about their atrocious education. They get rewarded for writing crap woke in college and it carries over. Thank you for the $50, by the way. You are absolutely correct. It is the universities, the art universities that were supposed to specialize people for Hollywood who have ended up usurping it, for lack of a better term. They've completely vandalized it and destroyed it. These art institutes and like, supposedly Moses Ingram went to like one of the best acting schools there is, you know? Yeah.
Really? They failed her.
Yeah.
No, I met a college professor on a flight once who basically said the biggest problem, this is like over a decade ago, and I never forgot this, said the biggest problem with the institutions today is grade inflation. So there's just grade inflation and the fear that, you know, because what they instituted was this thing where you grade the professor, so you're done with the course and you get the opportunity to give feedback to the professor, effectively grade the professor. And in living in fear of that, college professors are way too soft on students. And so, yeah,
you get what you get about that a little bit. Yeah.
Also, Jonathan Haidt, HAIDT, look up his comments on that. And the, you know, he's spoken very, very eloquently about all those problems.
But you're absolutely correct. And Arantu for $5 says, to be fair about Albuquerque, all the land around it is all reservations or army bases. So you can't actually build there. That is true, but I'm talking about the entire south portion of the state, that driving down to Texas. There are a couple, there is a literal ghost town, like a recent one. Like I would argue in the last 20 years, this thing has been abandoned. There's a couple of houses that you drive through. You drive through this town. I forgot the name of it. It's in the middle of fucking nowhere. And my wife and I are driving through it and like, oh shit, this looks like a post-apocalyptic video game. You know, there's like, it was crazy. But no, there's not a lot of peeps out here in the West, but you could also drive through, say, Central California. There's a lot of fucking nothing. You go up the coast of California. Take one. It's one of the most beautiful drives you can take. You take it through, you know, Big Sur and all the way down. Mm-hmm. There's a lot of fucking nothing. And it's coastal land, you know. The overpopulation is bullshit. It's absolute, utter bullshit. We have plenty of room to grow. I mean, that's the kind of stuff that people who've, like, you know, like in San Francisco, the one thing that I found the strangest when I moved there is there is a large, large portion of the population that lives in the really very downtown area that's never left it. Like they don't drive. They don't fly anywhere. They just leave their little apartment. They go to their bodega grocery stores, which do mostly suck, by the way. I don't buy any produce in those things if you value your stomach. And they just walk around downtown. They go to their clubs and they just stay in that little, it's like Manhattanites, the ones who never fucking leave, you know,
and they tell everybody else, go get cultured. Okay.
Right. Exactly.
Move out of your country house
right there. It's like, you don't even fucking drive. You've never been to the suburbs. You don't know what the fuck you're talking about. You've never seen the rest of America. And that, like, all of California is starting to turn in that now. There's a lot of good parts of California still. Unfortunately, they will never have power again. I never thought I'd leave my home state for political reasons. That's one I did not see coming.
Well, and cheap gas too, Garrett. Don't forget cheap gas.
How much is gas where you are, Chris?
I'm paying like six in the low six range, 609, 619.
You're using the app.
I'm using a couple apps, so I'll save like anywhere from 20 to 40 cents, depending. So, but it also just makes me think, do I want to like go drive to do this thing or just not do that thing? And lately it's been, I'm not going to do that thing. And it's weird. There's just certain things like, I'm not going to buy that anymore. You know, like I just not doing it. It's bizarre. So go ahead, Gary. Sorry.
No, I was just going to say what sold me on Texas was when we came here a year and a half ago. Mm-hmm. The gas was $2. $2. And like all the food was like half the price it was in California. I'm like, why am I in California? It's not like I don't go fucking surfing. Okay. So I don't surf. I'm going to the fucking beach. Kind of stay in my house all the time. Yosemite, I loved. You can't get in there. It's over a year waiting list. San Francisco fucking sucked, and I always kind of hated it. But I don't need to live here anymore. You know, I can see my friends on a live stream whenever I want. And I haven't missed it at all. Texas, total hellhole. You don't want to move here, though. Just Texans are all shut up, dude. Shut up. Stop it. It's terrible. I had to fit my wife for a handmaiden's outfit like soon as I got here.
Oh, that's the worst.
Yeah. Okay. I'm going to read a couple, then we got to go. You got a live stream later, don't you, Chris?
Yeah, like 30 minutes.
In 30 minutes. Oh, yeah, we got to let you go. So, all right, let me read it. This is Tolkien, but without the L and the I. It says Thomas Wright for $2. Tolkien. Okay, yeah. Paw Patrol, the movie, got it right, says Ruta Chris for $2. I didn't see Paw Patrol.
Even in that, there was a little bit of agenda. There's a scene where all the Paw Patrol's geared up to get their costumes on, and one of the dogs got a girl costume on, and they were like, if it makes you feel good, then it's okay. No. I looked over at my wife. I was like, what the hell is this shit?
Just dress up as a girl and shoot a bunch of people on 4th of July.
It was
a Trump supporter.
Yeah, as they do.
It's weird. And then it went silent. Yeah. Weird.
Weird.
Very sad though for them. Will Jon Snow waking the sleeper elder wake the sleeping elder gods? Asked Kelly Johns for $2. That would be fun. That would be awesome if they went that direction. But Dan and Dave, that's why Dan and Dave were always going to fail with Game of Thrones, because they hated the magic portion of it. And the thing was, it's not that prevalent in A Song of Ice and Fire. The one thing George does that's very cool is like magic is earned and it's deadly. and it's super deadly. I know there's Preston Jacobs out there who thinks everything's a hive mind and it's all sci-fi. No, there's fucking magic. George has said there's magic in the Song of Ice and Fire, the book that'll never finish. But yeah, you know, like shadow babies and shit like that. That stuff's cool as fuck. But like, yeah, it would cost her, and it would kill people, and sometimes it just didn't do what you intended it to do. I like that aspect of it. But the magic, quote unquote, in Lord of the Rings is even more nebulous, right? Like, well, okay, the rings have power. What kind of power? Well, the power to heal, the power to inspire, you know? But you don't see like a bolt of lightning coming out of, you know, Gandalf's hands. You know, it's like, yeah. It's I like it when they do that, you know? No, the Jon Snow show won't happen. I just don't think it'll happen. Chris saw Thor. Does Jane Foster get the iconic dual wielding hammers necro sword moment? Does she gain control of Gore's all black? F the MCU, says I be doughy for $4.99. Is that a, does she wield both hammers, Chris?
I'm trying to remember. No, she's not in the movie as much as you would think. She's not in the movie as much as you would think. She is a side character. And I mean that, and, you know, and that's a good thing, I think, you know?
I don't think, my thing is, I would have been, if it was Thor versus Gore, like, I'm down.
Right.
And we get to see the pantheon of Marvel gods and celestials and Kirby shit. And I'm like, oh yeah, like fucking, I would praise that to the end of the end of time. The one thing Taika Waititi got right in Ragnarok was some of the Kirby costuming and shit. Like, that's what I was praising about the movie. I'm like, fucking finally somebody does. Like, he's the first director to use Kirby crackle when Hela comes in. Like, when she first appears, it's a little bit of Kirby crackle. It's like, finally somebody does it. You know, but now it just sounds like, well, is there Kirby in this? Any Kirby that you feel like?
I would say a little, but it's all Taika Waititi filtered. So yeah, but not as much as you would think. Not full. I thought Eternals was going to be Kirby, and what
it should have been. Garbage that turned out to be. It was just the director didn't know fucking shit about Marvel Comics. That probably helps. If you would have hired somebody who knew who Jack Kirby was, that's all the Eternals, everything could be good. But instead of focusing on.
I think they're just going to forget they made the Eternals. It's just going to disappear. You think they'll bring any of those characters back or any of the Black Knight, plot lines? Or
the white guy. And they're going to connect him to Blade. And it's like, what? No, Black Knight should be an Avenger. Okay, he should be an Avenger. And then Blade should be introducing, like, I'm fine them using, like, I'm fine with the casting of Blade. It should be a Midnight Rated R movie. You introduce Ghost Rider, Man-Thing, Werewolf by Night, fucking Dracula, all the, just, and yeah, that's one of my favorite corners of the Marvel Universe. Probably my favorite corner of the Marvel Universe. And because of China, they haven't been able to make it, and I've been grateful for that. I'm like, thank God.
Keep it safe.
But now they're gonna fuck it all up. But you know, Ghost Rider, like, visually one of the coolest characters ever created, like, without a doubt. A fucking flaming skull dude riding a flaming fucking motorcycle who shoots hellfire out of his hands. That's fucking awesome. Everything about that's awesome. Former stunt, right? It's all full on 70s. It's great. Son of Satan. You could bring in the Son of Satan, but it'd probably make it the, you know, and yes, there is a daughter of Satan, but they would make it the daughter of Satan, and she'd be non-binary. And then Satan wouldn't be. They did a Son of Satan TV show, except it was the son of a serial killer. It was the son and daughter of a serial killer. And it's just the dumbest fucking idea ever. All right. I think we're gonna let me just check one more thing. We're gonna wrap it up. I've got a video to make, and we got an event at Comic-Con.
That's right.
Thursday, July 21st, at the Landmark Cinemas in Hillcrest. Chris Gore will be premiering his documentary. Now, it's not, he likes to say this, it's not the finished copy, because this
not
is
the
kind
premiere.
Of, it's kind of a test screening. Yeah, it's a test screening.
Yeah. It's the rough cut of the movie, which we're screening early just to get reaction to so we can finish it. This fall, we're going to have a proper premiere and whatnot. And then based on the level of interest, we might play a couple theaters just to, so people can go see it. But yeah, no, that's what's happening, dude. I cannot wait to just hang out, like just out, walk the gas lamp, you know, the event after. I cannot wait. The meetup is going to be awesome. It's going to be so fun. So dude, I'm just like, I'm pumped for San Diego, but not necessarily. I'm pumped for what we're doing. Not so much pumped for San Diego per se.
Yeah. You were mentioning. Dude,
yeah.
I'd be so fucking obnoxious about like, if like, I would relent on getting a test on a COVID test. I would get a COVID test. I'm fine with that. I just am not going to wear a fucking mask. I refuse. Utterly refuse.
I don't understand the point. If everybody has either the vax or a test, then and you have to do that, then what's the incentive? Fuck it. Like, yeah. And also, who are you giving this money to? I mean, it's just a shakedown for the medical industry, isn't it? Like, they created a new vertical to profit from. It's sickening.
There's an app that probably sponsored Comic-Con that they can use. Yeah. So
it's
a little payola, I imagine.
Yeah, the last 2 years has exposed all the bullshit, and I think a lot of people are awake, myself being among them, and I feel stupid for not being awake sooner when it comes to this stuff. Just what utter, it's just cash grabs from so many different industries taking advantage of people. But hey, let's go to the other thing is real quick, Gary. When you were on, maybe it was Real BBC or Tuesday night's main event, you were talking about some of the panels at Comic-Con. Someone needs to Alex. Yes. Someone needs to Alex Stein one of those panels. There needs to be the geek version of Alex Stein to go to one of those panels, get up and ask a really uncomfortable question.
Alex, I will give you my press pass, dude. I'll just ask Alex.
Oh my God. if Alex Stein could get up, and you know, like whenever, like I know you've been at panels, Gary, where someone gets up and you're like, oh no, and they start to ask a question that isn't a question. It's like this long-winded comment that has no, and then they just keep letting that person go, sort of like, okay, hurry and finish because we're not going to pay attention to you after this. We need Alex Stein to go to those panels and just be inquisitive and. Oh my God. His whole thing with the, when Antifa showed up at his comedy event and he called them arts and crafts. Antifa, please make that a t-shirt.
That was awesome. Thought it was
Where'd you get this? Joanne's Fabrics?
So great.
People,
oh my God,
people
Joanne's Fabrics.
I know people want me to go in and like, if it was real press, like I could go in and talk to the showrunners. I would fucking grill them. I would absolutely grill them on every question you guys had. And they'd give me probably some bullshit answer, but I'm not. I'm just going to be like, I'll be able to get into like a little pen, right? And probably have access to some panels that I'm not going to want to sit through.
Yeah.
Like, really don't. I've done Hall H. I don't, I like, even if like there was no mask, I would have no desire to go into fucking Hall H and sit there all fucking day for trailers that I can now see within minutes of the. See, back in the day, it was the only place you could see them. You know, it was 10 years ago. You could still get into Hall H. You didn't need to wear a mask. You hung out with your friends. You bullshitted. It was fine. But like, dude, it's a massive fucking line, right? And people stay overnight there. Now, I don't know what the numbers are going to be like because of this vaccine mandate. And I think what it's going to do is it's going to keep away all the cool people. So... fucking all the little vax zombies are going to be in there, and it's just it doesn't sound like the outside's going to be fine. I think that's fine. We'll just roll around.
Yeah, we'll just hang.
There's like San Diego's a fun place. Like we can get in a lot of trouble.
And I've never been there, man. I can't wait.
Oh shit! I'll take you. We'll go to Universal Studios too. I'll take you to Universal Studios.
Oh hell yeah!
Yeah,
hell yeah.
We'll go. Universal Studios.
I'm 30 and I've never been to a Universal Studios.
Oh, what?
I feel so sad
it's
about
fun,
it.
Dude. Oh,
it's really fun. Cool. Yeah.
Yeah.
But yeah, we're going to wrap it up there. So thanks, everyone. Thanks to the Modrotics. Thanks to everyone who left a super chat donation. We really appreciate you. Chris Gore, anything you'd like to plug?
Well, Gary and I are going to be doing San Diego Comic-Con. Garrett will be there. I don't know if anyone else is going to be there. I'm sure you'll find out by then, but looking forward to that. And then I'm doing a live stream in like 20 minutes. I may be a few minutes late, so my apologies, but hail to the chat. Thank you for all the love and support, and looking forward to just hanging in San Diego. Like the con itself, I don't really care, but just like I see people at Comic-Con I only see at Comic-Con, people from the East Coast, people like from all over. And I just can't wait. I really just can't wait to sit in the hotel bar and have incredibly in-depth nerdy conversations and yelling at people about like those. I mean, that's the fun of it. Yeah. That's what FNT is. Oh yeah. That's just the conversations we would have at comic shops all the time. We just sort of yell and get really impassioned. Then we go, okay, what's the next? All right, moving on. You know what I mean? Like you captured that, Gary, in the form of a show. And I appreciate you for that and the whole FNT team. So I'm looking forward to just hanging out and talking nerd shit. So thank you.
Thank you. And I can't wait either. And what's the location of our meetup, Garrett?
It is at the U31 bar.
U31 bar. And that's in Hillcrest.
In North Park.
North Park, which is next to, which is near Hillcrest. Okay. It's not far. Mile and a half from Landmark Cinemas, which I used to live right next to. That's where I saw Batman Forever and Pulp Fiction, all those 90s movies. That's where I saw them because that's where I lived. I lived in on 4th Avenue.
Link in the description for the RSVP if there are still
in the description. Tickets. I would say just go there. Go anyway.
Show up anyways. Yeah, come on. Show up anyways.
Yeah.
It's more of a guideline than a rule.
Yeah, and there might be some like alternate meetups that are just kind of last minute that we go like, hey, let's go meet at a wherever and we'll figure it out.
They're asking who's on FNT. It is Elijah Schaefer. Elijah Schaefer on FNT this week.
Is Dave Landau out or in?
He's on the 12th, I believe.
Was he on the 12th? Okay, so all right. So yeah, it's Elijah Schaefer, then Dave Landau. No, that's not the 12th. Because Razor
Fist. Let me double check with him.
Yeah,
Razor Fist is 12th.
Razor Fist the 15th. It's the 15th, not the
12th. Oh yeah, it's the 6th. It is Dave. It is Dave. Dave and Elijah together.
It's Dave and Elijah Schaefer. So it's Dave.
That's gonna be crazy.
And Elijah Schaefer. And then following week, Razor Fist. Then we're in San Diego.
You gotta ask Elijah the question that everyone wants to ask.
Is he gay?
No.
I know the answer is yes.
You gotta ask him what happened with You Are Here and Sydney and all that. Like there've been just mild. I feel like that's the question.
I think it's just this is purely my speculation. I would call it some things don't work out.
Yeah,
that's pretty much what I've gotten.
Yeah,
like my first marriage. You know, it's nothing. It was nothing earth shattering. It's just it didn't work out. You know.
Yeah. Yeah. Same here, actually.
Yep. Yeah. Yeah. Kind of just petered out. You know, it was like nothing like big. It's just like we're both better off for it. Quarter Black, anything you'd like to plug?
My wife. my channel. No, if you guys want to come check out,
how many kids you got already?
Wait, that's true. Yeah, I gotta nip tuck that, get rid of that. Go to my channel. You can watch my latest fall down the rabbit hole of Ezra Miller, and just give me a pat on the back for going down that dark road.
That is a
and
dark
road. We live stream some video games every once in a while. Play with Az and X-Ray Girl on Sundays. So come check me out.
I will. And they will too. And Jessica for $20 says, Gary, if you like Skinwalker Ranch, no, I love Secret of Skinwalker Ranch. Okay. Like I've seen, I watched all the episodes like three times. That's, I love that show. Watch, read Skinwalkers at the Pentagon. It's a very interesting book. Ooh, I will. I will. No, Skinwalker Ranch has been something I've been very interested in for many, many years since I first heard about it on Art Bell. Art Bell. So, yeah. And more news on a possible paranormal show in the future. Uh-oh. In the future. So we're going to wrap it up. Again, we're going to just end it because we really got to go. Chris has got to go. Chris, thanks for joining us. We love you, man. Can't wait to see you in San Diego. It's going to be fun. We're just a couple weeks away. And we'll see what happens. So take care, everyone. Be good to each other. Don't watch The Rings of Power. Don't.
Watch our videos on Rings of Power.
Our videos, but if you're looking for Tolkien, there's a lot of great, great books out there that I could not recommend enough. And if you want to go the audiobook route, and I'm not being paid for this, Audible has some great audiobooks. Some of the readers for Tolkien's work are top notch, including Christopher Lee.
Funny enough, you think Amazon would know they own Audible. They have all the books on file.
They do. Yeah.
They're still messing it up.
Just get those books. All right. Ciao, everyone.
Bye-bye.
Hi.
I am not gay. I have relationships with women. Sex with men.
And I got news for you.
Take a life. Do you want to cross that line? Because it's a long way back from hell.
NerdErotic.com.